Dr. Santan Gopal, our President AIUS, Dr. Ajit Babu Maji, our Vice President, President-elect AIUS, and me, Dr. Debashish Bhattacharya, your past President AIUS. We are here. There's one change in the judges. Dr. P.K. Mathur will be there. We're slightly waiting for him. He's on his way. Do you know the sequence of your presentations? So I'll just read it out. The first presenter will be from Cataract, Outcomes of a Management Strategy in Eyes with Corneal Irregularity and Cataract. Dr. Matthew Kurian. No, Dr. Tejal S.J. Concepts to Economic Impact, a Novel Indigenous Low-Cost Camera for ROP Screening in Community. That's the second presentation. Do all dry eyes complain?
Raise your hand so that we can know that candidate is there.
Do all dry eye complain patients have really dry eyes? Dr. Revati. Novel altered critical intracellular signaling events in keratoconus and its therapeutic potential. Dr. Natasha. Diagnostic value of optical coherence and electroretinography parameters in primary open-angle glaucoma. Dr. Punita. Diabetic retinopathy and systemic factors.
Please, Dr. Amrithi.
Optical coherence and angiography correlation study. Dr. Santosh. Role of vitamin D and dendritic cells in symptomatic evaporative dry eye disease, Dr. Rashmi.
Rashmi Deshmukh.
Abnormal anatomical variations in pediatric eyes with short axial length, Dr. Mayuri.
She's there, she's in the
Dr.
other.
Dr. Mayuri, come on.
No, no, she told.
Okay. Best paper from Telangana Ophthalmic Society, Dr. Swati. Comparison of cosmetic and functional results in subciliary external DCR and conventional external DCR, Dr. Gupta.
VP Gupta.
Prospective evaluation patterns of ERG changes in cases of unilateral optic neuritis. Dr. Goel, time domain anterior segment optical coherence in ocular surface squamous neoplasia, Dr. Rath, Bowman's imaging, a novel imaging marker for detection of keratoconus, risk factors for orbital implant exposure after evisceration, Dr. Gupta, Rashmi. So Dr. Rashmi Gupta, evaluation of selective intra-arterial chemotherapy, Dr. Bhavna Chawla, topo-guided cross-linking outcome study and its relationship to cellular biomarkers, best paper from All Gujarat Ophthalmic Society, Dr. Jitendra Jethani. Best paper from Jharkhand Ophthalmic Society, The Lines of Vision, Dr. Sneha Batra. Polymerase chain reaction and correlation with treatment response in tuberculous uveitis, Dr. Bhagya. PCV and CSR diseases of the same spectrum, Dr. Vani Seth. So I think we can start.
Yeah, I think so.
6 minutes.
Yeah. 6 minutes. Each presentation is strictly 6 minutes, and this is a competitive session, so people who exceed time will lose the marks. So you keep up the timing, after that there will be one or two questions from the judges. The, From the floor, we do not entertain questions because it's likely to be a biased questions. So we discourage questions from the floor. Now, can I call upon Dr. Tejal? She will be presenting on outcomes of management of strategy in eyes with cornea irregularity and cataract.
Good morning, everyone. So we have no financial disclosures to make. So now we usually come across a lot of patients who've undergone refractive procedures in the past and who come back to us for cataract surgery. So in these individuals, the only concern that a cataract surgeon would have if it is a decentered ablation or if it is an irregular anterior surface, how is the postoperative outcome going to be? Are we going to expect any refractive surprise in this individual is the concern of every cataract surgeon. So as we know that the corneal aberrations and the lenticular aberrations sum up to the total aberrations. So even if we are going to do a cataract surgery and put in a perfect lens, total aberration is still not going to change in the individual because the corneal asphericity is not being taken care of. So the research question that we asked ourselves was if we could treat the irregularity of the cornea and then do the cataract surgery. So we had a patient who came to us who had undergone a LASIK procedure many years ago and she had developed cataract presently. So when we did a corneal topography, we found that there were areas of central island. And when we used a topo-guided system, that is a topolizer, which takes around 8 readings in the target aspheric zone, so it gives us an ablation profile. So when we mapped it on the corneal topography and we did the ablation, we found that the cornea relatively became aspheric in this individual. Accordingly, when we see the ray trace aberrometry also, the corneal internal optics and the corneal optics show us that there are a lot of aberrations. This was pre-treatment. And post the customized ablation, we found that the corneal irregularity slightly decreased in this individual. So there have been a lot of studies which say that custom contoured ablation pattern method can be used in the treatment of decentered ablation. But how can we apply it as a cataract surgeon? Is probably a topo-guided treatment would help us to predict our IOL power calculation in a better way. So the aim of our study was to evaluate the outcomes of a management strategy in patients with irregular corneas and cataract. So it was a prospective interventional case series where eyes with post-LASIK corneal irregularities and who had symptomatic cataract were selected for the study. Minimal pachymetry was around 400 microns. So we excluded the patients with any autoimmune collagen vascular disease or even suspect keratoconus or any ectasias. So any individual who came for a cataract surgery and who had undergone a refractive surgery in the past, we did a topography on them to see if there's any irregularity in the corneal surface. So if there was, then we did a topolizer, a topo-guided treatment done on these individuals, and then we performed the cataract surgery. So in the topo-guided treatment, we did not change the refraction of these individuals. We changed the Q value and the C4 and the C12, that is the defocus and the spherical aberrations, just to make the cornea more aspheric. So since we do not have any standard protocol which says that you have to wait for a certain number of time after doing a topo-guided treatment to go ahead with cataract surgery, we did keratometry in these individuals over a period of 1.5 months to see if there was any change in the value. So when we found that the standard deviation was around 0.2 diopters, we went ahead and did the cataract surgery. So to calculate the IOL power, we used the online ASCRS calculator. And out of 6 eyes of our patients, 3 right and 3 left of 4 patients, the mean age was around 41 to 45 years. The duration of LASIK was around 8 to 10 years. And the SPSS version 17 was used for statistical analysis in these individuals. So efficacy-wise, we followed up these patients over a period of 1 year, and we found that the change in the value was less than 0.5 diopters in most of the individuals. And the procedure was safe. So we found that there was 1.3 diopters of difference in the IOL power calculation with the keratometric values pre and post surface regularization. So if we had done a cataract surgery in these individuals before doing a topo-guided treatment, then we could have probably expected a refractive or a residual error of 1.3 diopters in these patients. So to conclude, surface regularization of irregular corneas before cataract surgery, it ensures more predictable IOL power calculation and reduces the chances of refractive surprises post-surgery. So the limitation of our study was that it's a smaller sample size. We do not have a control group. And the duration of after the topo-guided treatment was 6 weeks because there was a need for early visual rehabilitation. But we are working on it. The numbers are bound to increase with time. So the results are being used for peer review, and we will expand the study to a case control or a randomized control trial. And if the strategy seemed to work, then we can consider this as an option for irregular astigmatism of all etiologies before cataract surgeries. So the take-home point would be that any irregular cornea, it's better to do a topo-guided treatment, regularize the cornea, and then do a cataract surgery. So we call it the CCC, that's the corneal customization before cataract surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, Tejal. It's quite a new concept where you actually, the general practice is we do that after the cataract surgery,
yes,
right? And
yes.
So here, I think your control was the biometric findings that you had
before
the treatment,
yes, sir,
and versus
after
the
treatment,
and you assumed that you had a better prediction,
yes,
of the IOL PAR,
yes,
right?
Yes, sir. So the only thing why we did not do the top-up later was it cornea can be sometimes unpredictable because this eye is not a virgin eye. Patients have already gone a refractive procedure in the past. So we didn't know what could be the myopic or the hyperopic shift post-procedure. So we thought it's better to treat the eye, the cornea first, then predict what exactly the eye wall would be, and then go ahead with the cataract surgery. So that's why we waited.
But you could have corrected it post also, because that will give you a correction of the residual or the surgically induced problem that can also be tackled if you do it later on.
Yes, so we can do that, but the only issue would be we don't know how the cornea is going to behave. So what if there is a more shift than what we actually expect in this individual? That was the only concern that we had.
You may need two procedures, one before and one after,
yes, sir,
if there is a surprise.
No, but then very interesting, and it's a new concept. A very nice paper, Tejal. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
The next is the concept to economic impact, a novel indigenous low-cost camera for ROP screening in the community. Dr. Anand Vinayaka.
Respected judges and my dear friends, the video shows you why we need this new invention. I have no commercial interest, but I am an honorary technical advisor to a member of Government of India Task Force, and I'm also the unpaid PI for a DBT trial. The problem statement as we saw it 10 years ago was the fact that there were more than 35 lakh babies born preterm every year with less than 100 ROP specialists, almost none in the rural areas. So what we started was a rural telemedicine program where we used an expensive, bulky, imported camera, took it into the rural NICUs, trained non-doctors to take pictures, upload them on a secure telemedicine platform, and have it read remotely on the smartphone of the ROP expert. What started off as 3 centers has slowly grown to 107 through a public-private partnership. We're almost covered our 1 lakh baby and treated 1,800. The Supreme Court in 2015 said that ROP screening is now essential newborn care, paving the way for an all-India expansion. So what is the big barrier for this all-India expansion? It's obviously the cost of the camera, hence the need for this invention. The aim of this free paper is to present to you this invention, compare it with the gold standard, and study its economic benefit in the community. This is a prestigious DBT trial with industry partners Forus, technology partners IIT Chennai, and us as the clinical validators. The prototype started almost 5 years ago, and we slowly improved in the form, the factor, the field, the illumination. And by the time we were able to get our first complete device, as you can see in the video on the left, this is rather bulky. The older version was able to produce wide field images, but you'd agree that the quality was not good enough. So we went back to the drawing board, improved the hardware and the software, established its safety in 140 babies, and obtained the ethics committee approval. The sleeker, more portable, newer version, which is now in market for the past 4 months, produced much better quality images, was also lighter. You can see much more better retinal vasculature details as it goes into the ora serrata. This current version sits in a briefcase and is so portable it can be taken on a two-wheeler, let alone the hand carry of a plane. This is not reverse engineering. We have 2 international patents, one for the liquid lens and one for the illumination source. Even the images produced by the Neo are larger than that of the retcam. As you can see in the arc, both superior and inferior retina give you extra. Also, it is less bulky. As you can see in the photo, it's lighter and it's cheaper. It's about 12 to 15 lakhs and expected to be under 10 soon. Since the images look different, we had to crop them to resemble each other, which is what we did, and presented it to two ROP specialists. One of them was Professor Dogra from PGI, and the outcome was tested in over 1,000 babies. The demographics are nothing special, so I'll pass on that. But look at the images. They show you something very subtle. This is stage 2 in zone 3, picked up on the new device, the red panel on top, and the bluish tinge on the gold standard. This is immature retina picked up on the Neo and the gold standard. Mature retina, which means we are able to now pick up blood vessels reaching the ora serrata on the Neo and the gold standard. This is a baby that needed treatment. Uncropped images, stage 3 with zone 2 with plus, and you can see it's picked up. The limitations of the device currently are the fact that we have not been able to master the mid-vitreous focus. We have not tested on babies more than 4 months of age, and it's only on Indian babies. The sensitivity has remained high, but the specificity is something that we've been able to improve from 40 to the late 70s by reducing the edge artifacts. But the true benefit of a device comes only when it serves the community. So we did a cost-benefit analysis. We used the help of IIM Bangalore. They did a very detailed cost coverage on us. Let me summarize the findings. To set up a telemedicine program now with this new device, it will cost us just 1/5 of the current model, and to keep it running will cost us just half. This means to a patient who has to pay for the screening, this is going to be 6 times cheaper. And for those who's funding the program, it's going to be almost 5 times cheaper. With wide field imaging being considered the new gold standard instead of indirect ophthalmoscopy in the current medico-legal climate, with Government of India now declaring that retinal imaging is a viable alternative to indirect ophthalmoscopy in its new guidelines, and with hundreds of NICUs being mushrooming across rural India, it's probably time for us to replace an expensive imported device with a made-in-India portable robust camera. We have saved more than 411 crores of blindness in the past 10 years. If we extrapolate that to 9 states which have the ROP problem, we can save 3,500 crores if we use the new camera compared to 700 crores in the current model. But numbers are for politicians. For you and me as clinicians, it's the baby that matters. This is baby Sanvi, who was picked up with very severe ROP 6 years ago, treated successfully, and now has vision to see her preterm brother also with the same problem, but this time picked up on the Neo. Maybe it is time for us to allow this miracle to repeat itself. A small salute for all those who've been part of this wonderful journey. Thank you.
Anand, did you compare this with the images of the retcam with a blinding?
Yes, sir. The 1,008 babies were actually, all babies were imaged same time, same session, both cameras. The first baby of the day would be imaged with the retcam first. The next baby would be with the Neo first. This was to prevent image bias that would happen if we kept using only one device all the time first, because we know that if we apply too much pressure, we can change the vasculature.
Yeah. No. What I'm asking is that image readers,
sir,
are they blinded?
Yes, sir. They were blinded. That's why we had to crop those images. Both the new image is square because it uses a square sensor. The retcam is rectangular. So if we gave it like that to the expert, they would know where it came from. So we cropped the Neo image to make it rectangular on a software, made both of them have the same aspect ratios, and they were presented to two ROP specialists who did not know which device it came from, but they were told the birth weight, gestational age, and the age at which the screening was done. They had to then say whether there was ROP and what they would do, whether they would follow up, treat, or discharge. This was done in 1,008 babies.
What was the agreement?
The kappa coefficient was more than 0.85. That's 85% of inter-observer variability. We also redid 10% of the images to check intra-observer variability, and that was more than 95%.
Okay. And you said the cost of the camera is 12 lakhs right now, and it may likely to come down.
Correct, sir.
Would you use this as a screening tool in a wide range, or you would advise that one mobile van will be going around and it will pick up the
intention to create a low-cost camera is so that every SNCU will have its own, so that we don't have to port it around. In the current model, we have already started using it in parts of rural Karnataka, where we are porting it around. But as the cost goes down and as governments support this initiative, because it's under the Make in India scheme, We feel that with the cost coming down, every NIC will have its own camera so that more babies get covered even at the sub-district level.
Just being a little curious, have you have any experiences with this MyRedCam, which is much, much cheaper?
Yes. So the MyRedCam is good for adults. It's probably good for the posterior pole of babies, not so much for an ROP imaging device. Reason being, it's non-contact. These babies are imaged unanesthetized in the outpatient. You do need a contact device. Initially, the DBT wanted us to try a non-contact device, but it works only if you're going to examine all babies under general anesthesia, which is not feasible. So it's a great device, but it's not going to come into the ROP segment as of now.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you.
Now we call upon Ravati Subramani. She's not there, okay. So next presentation is by Natasha Pahuja. She will be presenting on novel altered critical intracellular signaling events in keratoconus and its therapeutic potential. Dr. Pahuja.
Thank you. So essentially we are looking at keratoconus with a slightly different perspective. So what is the profound impact when we look at this? We think that the housekeeping of this person is not in order. So this is what happens in body. What is responsible for housekeeping in the body is autophagy. What it essentially does is it takes all the misfolded proteins and debris and it forms an autophagosome, a membrane outside it, and it transports into lysosome for degradation. Having understood this concept and idea, which also won the Nobel Prize in the last year, we wanted to see if it has any role in keratoconus. Now, keratoconus, we know the causes. It has got established genetic causes, and it has got known risk factors, environmental factors. Oxidative stress happens to be one of the most important risk factors. Now, if there is oxidative stress, what is the first response in the body? It is autophagy. So, having understood this molecular pathway, we wanted to create or simulate this experimental model in the cell lines. So what we essentially did was we simulated oxidative stress in cell lines. How is it done? Very simple. You expose human corneal epithelial cell lines to hyperoxia, which induces oxidative stress. Now, after doing this, we wanted to prove this concept. So this is a small clipping, what we did in the lab. We essentially cultivated all these cell lines, and these cell lines underwent gene expression analysis to understand the expression of these cell lines, the Western blot for proteins, flow cytometry for inflammatory markers, and most importantly, fluorescein imaging to understand the morphology of these cells. So having covered the entire spectrum of analysis, we found that if the cells are exposed to oxidative stress, or if there is oxidative stress, there is reactive oxygen species, which alters the autophagy markers, as seen here in LC3 and LAMP1. The same story unfolds on Western blot analysis on LC3 and LAMP1, which says that the autophagy is blocked. Even better, we also found this on morphology, where these yellow bodies in the hyperoxic state are showing increased autophagosomes, again showing increased oxidative stress, which is showing altered autophagy. So, having understood all this, we wanted to see if this lab experiment truly happens in patients as well or not. So we studied this in patients to understand if this is a responsible factor for pathogenesis of keratoconus. Essentially what we did here is we collected the epithelium from the center of the cornea, which is the ectatic area, and the non-ectatic area from the periphery, stored it in a biorepository, and we had a very strict inclusion and exclusion criteria. Interestingly, every experiment that was done on the cell lines showed similar results on patient epithelium. But what is even more interesting is that if we look at the cone area or the ectatic area, it had defective autophagy. But the same eye of the same patient in the non-ectatic area had normal markers for autophagy, which means the disease is localized and it is significantly altered in the cone area. So having understood this, we have established that the cone area is more affected as compared to the periphery, and there's defective autophagy in keratoconic eyes. So is this the responsible factor? We wanted to prove our hypothesis. So essentially what we did was we have certain therapeutic targets in this pathway of autophagy and oxidative stress. We wanted to see if by blocking oxidative stress or regulating autophagy, can we prevent this? We went back to our cell lines, induced oxidative stress, showed defective autophagy, treated with chloroquine. Why chloroquine? Because it's commercially available and it's easily available. Having treated with chloroquine, we found that we could restore autophagy again. So, we know that there are environmental factors. These environmental factors cause increased reactive oxygen species on the ocular surface. Now, these reactive oxygen species affect the cells by increasing oxidative stress. Now, imagine if the cleaning mechanism is out, there is going to be, which is the altered autophagy, these cells are going to go on accumulating, inducing inflammation. Now, we know that metalloproteinases affect the collagen matrix and cause degradation, which essentially explains why there is progressive ectasia in keratoconus. Now, we have also established that drug targets, at least on the cell lines, are proving beneficial. So what we'd like to conclude saying that autophagy is an important cell survival mechanism which has been established. Oxidative stress is deregulating autophagy. Most importantly, this is the first time that we have established this in keratoconus in eyes, showing a new mechanism for altered intracellular pathway. And modulation of autophagy is possible, at least in cell lines, by these therapeutic targets. So potentially there may be no cross-linking 5 years down the line. So what are we essentially trying to say? We know that defective autophagy has been established in systemic factors. We have studied in eye. But what this study adds is that we have studied a novel mechanism for the first time in the pathobiology of keratoconus. But this is in cell lines. We have validated in patients. The treatment is yet to be established in patients. We're trying to see if we can mark it by a simple dipstick method and prove it further. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Natasha.
Suresh, would you want to ask a question?
Moving further from what you said, would you say that, for example, chloroquine or any other new drug could be used as a treatment for diseases where altered autophagy is known to causes, one of them being keratoconus?
Yes.
That's what you were hinting at when you said that C3R would be obsolete in a few years.
So what I'm essentially trying to say is C3R is a treatment strategy. It is not a preventive strategy. What we are trying to see if we can block specific markers or specific pathways which are progressing keratoconus at a very early stage. So probably this will be helpful. We have shown that cyclosporin in early keratoconus, if you remove the inflammation, the progression is halted in most of the patients. We are trying to simulate the same thing to other drugs as well. Simple as that. Yeah.
Dr. Natasha.
Yes, sir.
The normal corneal epithelial cells migrate from the periphery to the center. They belong to the same stem cell line. Now, why do you think that as soon as they cross some aspect or some region of the cornea, the autophagy becomes abnormal?
It's a brilliant question, sir. So what happens is, essentially, when the cells migrate, by the Thoft hypothesis, the XYZ hypothesis, when the cells migrate, there is a crosstalk between the basement membranes, between the stroma and the epithelium. So the crosstalk is which is causing the changes in the epithelium, which is localized in the cone. Now, if you look at grade 3 keratoconus, the difference between cone and periphery is very, very less. That means if you look at the same autophagy markers, there is not too much difference between the center and the periphery, or the cone and the non-ectatic area, which essentially saying as the disease progresses, the ectasia progresses, this is also affecting the epithelial cells. So irrespective if they migrate or not, there is some crosstalk happening below the basement membrane, which is changing the morphology of these cells.
Did you study in normalize in comparison with the keratoconus cells?
Yes. So the PRK patients were the normal R controls because there's no other way we can get derive epithelium from any other source. So we found that the autophagy markers were absolutely normal in in the center and in the periphery in PRK patients. And these markers were same as the non-ectatic area of the keratoconus size.
That was not included.
It was, sir. The PRK patients were included.
Essentially, the keratoconus is an epithelial problem, primarily. and then the stroma gets affected due to whatever problem is there in the epithelial cells. Am I correct in assuming that that progression in keratoconus, essentially the problem in the autophagy in the epithelial cells, which leads to the problem in the stroma? So what we are doing in C3R is treating the stroma, but nothing, doing nothing to the epithelial.
Did you have any RCT with the chloroquine versus the C3Rs?
Well, sir, the chloroquine has not been tried on patients.
Okay.
It has been only on cell lines. So if we are treating keratoconus patients, which is not the standard of care, with chloroquine, we will have to, we had to first validate this if it happens in cell lines and then take it up to the patients.
Right. Thank you. Thank you. Nice.
Now can I call upon Punita Kumari Sodhi? She will be presenting on diagnostic value of optical coherence tomography and electroretinography parameters in primary open angle glaucoma.
Honorable chairpersons and my dear friends, today I am going to speak on diagnostic value of parameters of optical coherence tomography and pattern electroretinography in primary open angle glaucoma. No financial interest. The techniques have been studied because they diagnose glaucoma at a pre-perimetric stage. Optical coherence tomography measures the parameter of retinal nerve fiber layer, ganglion cell count, and optic nerve head. Flash electroretinography, it measures the change in the voltage responses of retinal ganglion cells in response to the reversing checkerboard pattern. This is the formation of P50 and N95 waves. This is a reversing checkerboard pattern whose frequency can be fixed. And this is the placement of electrodes on the forehead, lateral canthus, and the one touching the cornea. The flash electroretinography measures the voltage response of retinal ganglion cell in response to the flashes of light. The A wave, B wave, and photopic negative response, that is PHNR, amplitude and latency, are measured. This is the monitor showing the waveforms. Ganzfeld bulb showing the flashes of light. And this is the placement of the electrodes. Though the authors have studied these parameters in various disease conditions and they have also measured the changes, but the diagnostic and the screening value of these tests at a pre-perimetric stage in the glaucoma has not yet been found. There is a need for good screening test and a good diagnostic test. The aim of the study was to find the diagnostic value of OCT and ERG parameters in a primary open angle glaucoma. The gadgets are sparsely available and knowledge is not widespread. To the best of our knowledge, this is the first original study on this subject. Non-randomized intervention study on 71 open angle glaucoma patients in the age range of 20 to 60 years, with each subject having at least 6x60 of best corrective visual acuity in each eye, and not having any optic nervous central nervous disorders which could affect the optic nerve function, or confound results were taken. OCT and ERG parameters were measured and compared with the normal values. Normal and abnormal out of these parameters were plotted against the normal and abnormal values of the standard diagnostic test, that is fundus changes and mean deviation and pattern standard deviation more than 6 on the fields. Sensitivity is equal to true positive divided by true positive plus false negative, and specificity is equal to true negative divided by false positive plus 2 negative. These are the results. Males predominated and 51 to 60 years of age group predominated. 27% has systemic disease, 4% family history. With fundus changes as standard, we found in OCT, focal loss of volume, vertical cup to disc ratio, and retinal nerve fiber layer inferotemporal were most sensitive. And ganglion cell count, average optic nerve head disc area, and retinal nerve fiber layer superotemporal and superonasal most specific. These are the monitor of the OCT machines showing how these parameters look like, and they have been shaded by me to show the most sensitive and specific parameters. With in PERG and flash ERG, in N95 amplitude, A wave latency and PHNR amplitude are most sensitive, and N95 latency and A wave amplitude are most specific. With mean deviation values of field, we found that focal loss of volume, vertical cup to disc ratio, retinal nerve fiber layer superotemporal most sensitive, and the GCC average optic nerve head disc area and retinal nerve fiber layer superior nasal were most specific. With ERG, N95 amplitude, A latency and PHNR amplitude were most sensitive, and N95 latency and A wave amplitude were most specific. With using PET and standard deviation values in the field, similar results were found. We also found the predictive value of these parameters by plotting receiver operating curves using the critical value which maximized both sensitivity and specificity and also balanced these. The curve having a maximum area under it would have higher predictive value. A ganglion cell count average, superior and inferior were not predicted in case of fundus changes, but they were in case of field changes. Similar results were retinal nerve fiber layer. The P50 amplitude in PET and ERG and A wave and B wave amplitude and PHR and amplitude had higher predictive value. These parameters have not been studied earlier for the diagnostic values. We conclude that OCT, focal loss of volume, vertical cup to disc ratio, inferotemporal quadrant, RNFL, N95 amplitude and A wave latency, PNHR amplitude are good screening tests, and ganglion cell count average, optic nerve head disc area, retinal nerve fiber layer, nasal upper, N95 latency and A wave amplitude have good diagnostic test value. And I recommend that these parameters should be used in preference to other for good screening and diagnosing the glaucoma disease. And those which are having high predictive value should be considered as high risk factors. And if they are found abnormal, we should follow up the patient more closely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Punita. Is there anything in the literature to say that, you know, primary open angle glaucoma, which is proved on field analyzer, and there's some ERG studies on that?
Yeah, there are several studies I have quoted also by Sehi et al., Shortman et al., and Ventura and Porsetti. They have found that pattern ERG and in flash ERG, photopic negative response. These are specific for diagnosing glaucoma. Literature says that multifocal ERG is not a diagnostic test. So whatever the three techniques were available, I have investigated all of them with all parameters studied in the same set of patients, which has been done for the first time, because authors have studied the parameters, but they have studied one or two techniques and they have shown the changes. Thus, comparison is not possible.
Because ERG is a more difficult equipment for an institution rather than an OCT.
Yes.
Not only that, the standardization of ERG waves itself is so difficult. So how can you standardize the predictive value of ERG?
We found the normal values first in these. And we this was the
done a simultaneous normal patients and glaucoma patients?
No, the normal values were found first and then we used them on the patients.
Okay, thank you very much. Now I call upon Dr. Santosh Gopikrishna. His presentation is on diabetic retinopathy and systemic factors, optical coherence tomography, angiography correlation study.
Morning. I'll be talking about diabetic retinopathy and its systemic factors correlating the microvascular with optical coherence tomography angiography. There's no telling the grave course of diabetic retinopathy that's going to rise by 360 million by the year 2030. Diabetic retinopathy being a microvascular disease, fluorescein angiography and OCT are the only mainstay mode of investigations. But FAI also has its own limitations. So the aim of our study was to correlate retinal microvascular changes with severity and systemic factors in diabetic retinopathy using OCTA. It's a prospective observational cross-section study. We used OptaView and we used 3x3 scans over there. So a brief overview of OptaView, which we know that it's based on motion contrast and uses SADA algorithm by now. And this is the way the scan is made out, the superficial deep and vascular retina as well as the choriocapillary layers. So OCT images with significant defects were excluded, and these were the systemic parameters we kind of studied in this study. So the inclusion criteria were 209 eyes of 122 type 2 diabetic patients with a normal vision and 60 eyes of 31 patients as controls. Exclusion criteria, we excluded patients with macular edema, media opacities, higher and lower refractive errors, low vision, renal disease, hypertension, and any intraocular surgery focal or PRP or injections 6 weeks prior to imaging. We used local fractal method to segment and quantify FAZ. This was how the image was obtained. We initially binarized it, and then we used local fractal dimensional values. The warmer colors towards red, they indicate the presence of a vessel. It goes up to 1, and the colder colors, the blue colors, basically indicate vessel-free zones. And this was how we counted the vasculature by box counting method. The higher fractal dimension towards 1 indicated larger vessels, and vessel-free zones were indicated by lower values. So this is what we got, the large vessels, smaller vessels, and gaps between the vessels and FAZ as well. So this was a superficial and deep vessel network. You can see a closely knit pattern in the deep vasculature. So this is a contour map of the moderate NPDR, a distorted FAZ, with increasing in colder colors demonstrating the CNP areas. So moderate NPDR, again, superficial and deep layers. It's across different grades of NPDR and PDR. We can see progressively distorting FAZ and increasing colder areas there. Statistical analysis, the analyzed variables for FAZ area, vessel density and spacing between the large and small vessels. One-way ANOVA was performed, and we used ROC curve to see the sensitivity and specificity. A value of less than 0.05 was considered significant. These were the results across different age groups. When compared to normal individuals, it was statistically significant. In normal eyes, the FAZ had a lower area and higher vessel density and lower spacing between large and small vessels when compared to DR grades. In diabetic retinopathy, as seen in the p-values, the first one and second one, it was significant between the normal and DR grades, but wherein amongst DR grades, the spacing between large and small vessels was significant, and FAZ area did not really significantly change, and severe NPDR and PDR had higher spacing between large vessels. Mild NPDR had higher spacing between small vessels, and spacing between large vessels and spacing between small vessels were almost similar in both the layers. To correlate with systemic factors, in superficial layers, the spacing correlated positively with HbA1c, FBS, and PPBS, and the vessel density correlated negatively with the three parameters. Vessel density and spacing between large vessels had no correlation significantly with other systemic indicators. FAZ almost remained the same, and in deep layers also, it didn't show any significant statistical correlation. ROC area of FAZ had the lowest sensitivity and specificity. Vessel density had a little higher sensitivity, whereas spacing between large vessels had the highest sensitivity when compared to vessel density. So our study had its own limitations, wherein normal subjects were a little longer, projection artifacts and all had to be eliminated. It was a smaller sample size and a cross-section study. There were other studies which were done which showed that fractal dimension can be used to see the diabetic retinopathy changes, and diabetic retinopathy subjects had larger FAZ. But what's new in our present study is spacing between large vessels could be a better indicator in addition to the vessel density as well. And spacing between larger vessels and vessel density had a significant correlation with HbA1c, FBS, and PPBS levels. So to conclude, longitudinal assessment of these characteristics might help a stronger correlation in the future. And these OCTA characteristics and systemic factors can be used in combination to better understand diabetic retinopathy changes. OCTA is a great non-invasive and repeatable tool to study the in vivo microvascular changes and its systemic correlation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. OCT angiography.
Sir.
Although you keep saying angiography, it shows the anatomical things.
Right.
It does not show any changes in the physiological characteristics of the vessels or the basement membrane.
That's right.
Diabetic retinopathy is essentially a basement membrane problem.
Yes.
Now, the basement membrane problem precedes the anatomical changes, or it follows the anatomical changes, or they are simultaneous.
So basically, it starts with the anatomical changes, the endothelial outpouching and all that can lead to the leakage, and then the progressive dropout, capillary dropout and all. So it basically proceeds with the initial endothelial changes. So, but it's difficult to really make out those changes as such in OCT, as you said. It's basically the anatomical variations that we can see as a cross-sectional thing. But the leakage and all, yeah, that's not possible, sir, in OCT.
What future direction would you like to see with the current study?
Sir, a longitudinal study including more parameters, we basically had to exclude hypertension, renal disease, because these are obviously going to show quite a larger FAZ and more dropout areas. So if we include more factors, more variables, I think we can better determine what kind of changes and even if a better control of renal disease or hypertension. So the way that affects vascular changes are the reversible.
Knowledge of widening gap between the vessels is known.
Yes, sir.
What new observation did you find in this?
The systemic correlation, sir, because the systemic correlation wasn't done earlier. So I mean,
it is also known.
Yeah, it is known, but it was done through histopathological sections. But having an in vivo way to kind of study these things was something.
If I'm not mistaken, in your earlier slide, you said you took only patients with 6x6 vision for study.
Right, sir.
What percentage of these did you find abnormal OCTA?
No, these were all, because we had abnormal patients as well as normal patients as controls. So we had a range of diabetic retinopathy from mild to PDR as well.
No, so your one section of your study was for diabetic patients with 6x6 vision.
Yes, sir.
In that segment, how many of what percentage roughly had abnormalities detected on OCTA?
No, even 209 eyes, all of them had diabetic retinopathy abnormalities, mild, moderate, severe, as well as PDR, whereas 60 eyes were normal, actually.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Santosh, I'll suggest you not to crowd your slides.
Yes, sir. Actually, it was more of a statistical data, so I had to put in more of those.
I don't think we will comment on your slides because it's a competitive session and that also scores a mark.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. Dr. Rashmi Deshmukh, she's going to talk on role of vitamin D and dendritic cells in symptomatic evaporative dry eye disease.
Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I would like to declare that neither me nor any co-authors on the paper have any financial disclosures to make. To begin with, just consider a case scenario of a 30-year-old male patient coming with severe ocular pain and discomfort in the OPD. When we evaluate him for dry eye, we see that he has only a mild evaporative dry eye, but the patient is extremely symptomatic and the OSDI score is high. So we often see that the signs don't correlate with the symptoms every time, and tear film matrix cannot explain the patient's disproportionately high pain and discomfort. So what is the missing link? The research question we asked was, what is the cause of disproportionate pain in patients with mild evaporative dry eye? And the purpose was to study the association between serum vitamin D and symptoms, morphological changes in the cornea, and tear inflammatory proteins in evaporative dry eye patients. We studied 52 patients with mild evaporative dry eye with 43 age-matched controls. Dry eye evaluation was done for all of them, and OSDI scoring was done to look for symptoms. In vivo confocal microscopy, serum vitamin D, and tear cytokine profiling was done for all of them. Now, coming to what is OSDI, it's a validated questionnaire consisting of 12 questions. It can be subdivided into discomfort subscale and a vision subscale, and we were mainly concerned with the discomfort subscale in this study. In vivo confocal microscopy, counting of the dendritic cells was done, which were divided into immature and mature. So immature dendritic cells are just the cell bodies where the dendrites have not yet formed, and when the inflammation increases, they transform into mature dendritic cells where the tentacles have formed properly. And nerve analysis was done using automated CC matrix software, where blue color showed the nerve branches, red color showed the main nerve fibers, and green points were showing the branching points. Now, why did we look at vitamin D? Because there has been enough evidence to show that vitamin D deficiency is associated with ocular surface disorders, but there always has been a lack of mechanistic evidence as to why this happens. And there is a role of vitamin D in dry eye as well. Vitamin D deficiency has been shown to be associated with dry eye disease, and it also has a role to play in the regulation of the dendritic cells, which we normally see in inflammatory conditions in the cornea. And what was done with the tear strips was they were collected and stored at minus 80 degrees Celsius. The tears were then extracted from the Schirmer strip, and flow cytometry was done to do the cytometric bead array, and the cytokine profiling was done in all these patients. Now, coming to the results, we found a significant correlation between dendritic cell density and OSDI scoring. That meant that more the inflammatory cells, more was the discomfort. And when we correlated these things with vitamin D, we found an inverse correlation. That is, when vitamin D deficiency was there, the OSDI scores were higher, and the mature dendritic cells were also higher in these patients. That means when in dry eye disease with normal vitamin D levels, there were less inflammatory cells and low OSDI score. And in dry eye disease with low vitamin D levels, there were more inflammatory cells and more discomfort. Now, coming to the inflammatory profile, inflammatory cytokines like interleukin-17, ICAM-1, MCP-1 were all found to be raised in patients with dry eye disease. And correlating these with confocal microscopy, we found that interferon gamma is increased in all the cases of dry eye disease because of goblet cell loss. ICAM-1 predisposes to ocular surface inflammation, and MCP-1 causes dendritic cell recruitment. So that was the reason why we saw increased inflammation in these patients. Interleukin-17 is a pronociceptive factor, which is increased, and interleukin-2 is an antinociceptive factor, which is reduced, and this explained the high OSDI score in these patients. We also found an increase in interleukin-4 and 10, which are actually anti-inflammatory markers, but we hypothesized that it could be a compensatory mechanism to the already ongoing inflammation on the surface. So out of the 52 patients, around 30 patients had a low vitamin D. When it was a severe deficiency of less than 10, they were subjected to injectable treatments. And when it was up to 10 to 30, then they were given oral supplements and followed up. After 3 months of treatment, when patients were followed up, we found that their OSDI score had significantly improved and the dendritic cells had also reduced and the patients were much more comfortable. This is a graph which showed that 46 patients which we had followed up out of the 52 had a decrease in the OSDI score with the increasing vitamin D levels, which showed that there was an improvement in the symptomatology of these patients. Now, coming to the possible mechanisms of vitamin D, we see that in dry eye disease, it has a role to play in reducing the pro-inflammatory factors. It improves the goblet cell density, it improves the corneal epithelial function and metabolism, and it also reduces the nociceptive factors on the surface. So vitamin D indirectly causes increased inflammation and dendritic cell recruitment, causing subbasal nerve plexus changes, and directly it causes an activation of nociceptive factors. And these two together cause ocular pain and discomfort in these patients. So we can conclude that low vitamin D levels can result in severe symptoms despite having a mild evaporative dry eye by altering the tear inflammatory cytokine levels, and supplementation of vitamin D in addition to conventional therapy may hasten the symptomatic relief. So what we already knew was that serum vitamin D levels may be associated with dry eye disease, but what our study adds is the implication of serum vitamin D levels in pain and discomfort associated with mild dry eye disease, and hence vitamin D supplementation can be used as an adjuvant to the standard therapy for symptomatic relief in these patients. Thank you.
Did you take vitamin D same age group control, like without
the
dry
43
eye.
Age matched controls were those with no dry eye and no vitamin D deficiencies. Also, the patients who had dry eye but vitamin D normals were not taken into consideration. We have taken only those patients who had OSDI much more as compared to the signs and who had a vitamin D deficiency as well.
Because you say that about 60% of these patients had vitamin D deficiency, right?
Yes, sir.
So, I mean, in a sample of what, 60 patients?
The 52 patients that 52 we studied patients, were those so with vitamin D
the
deficiency.
Sample size being small, could you think that, you know, this variable probably would have been a normal deviation in a sample size of the same population?
So, sir, 52 patients we had studied both the eyes. So, actually the number of eyes studied were 104 eyes and 43 normal patients. So there were 104 eyes which were studied.
You yourself admitted that this dry eye without vitamin D deficiency would have also made some difference to your study. That is not included.
No, sir, that is not included
yeah,
in
that's
the study.
What you should have included that as well.
Okay.
Among the all the dry eyes which are presenting to you, you would have made two groups or studied all the dry eye patients. And
yes,
the
sir.
Percentage of vitamin D and the changes with vitamin D and without vitamin D would have made much more meaningful conclusions.
Yes, mainly in this study what we had shown was that the patients who were deficient already, only by supplementing they were feeling much more relief as compared to what they were before, because they kept on going to different places and they were being prescribed only lubricants because the evaporative dry is essentially mild and there was no corneal surface staining or any surface damage. So only by supplementation of vitamin D they had a symptomatic relief is what we were trying to show.
More of subjective than actually anything objective.
It is a subject, like a patient's subjective questionnaire we are taking.
When it is a subjective study, it is subjected to bias of the observer.
The OSDI questionnaire is actually
any subjective study, the observer bias cannot be removed easily.
Have you taken any step further?
So now we have just seen the follow-up of the patients. Beyond this, what you had suggested, we might want to try that patients with normal vitamin D, that's all.
Okay, thank you.
Rashmi, I mean, it's a very well-planned study that way. We've done everything for the patients. Now, you haven't added anything beyond lubricants, like no cyclosporine or...
Same treatment, only lubricants were going on for both the
groups.
You
added vitamin D.
Yes.
Can I now call upon Dr. Mayuri Kamar? She will be presenting on abnormal anatomical variations in pediatric eyes with shorter axial length.
Good morning. I'm going to present on abnormal anatomical variation in pediatric eyes with the shorter axial length. We know that the microphthalmic eyes with the congenital cataract are predisposed to develop glaucoma following cataract surgery. In our previously published study, it is seen 30.9% after 4 years follow-up. However, the abnormalities leading to the glaucoma development in these eyes has not been known. Keeping this in mind, we undertook this study to identify the morphological differences using UBM in ephakic eyes of the infants operated under the age of 1 year with shorter axial length less than 17 millimeter compared to the ephakic eyes of the infants with the normal axial length. The study was prospective observational comparative case series following congenital cataract surgery. It includes 35 eyes with the microphthalmos and they were compared with the 25 eyes without microphthalmos as a control. All infants were operated under the age of 1 year with the microphthalmos as well as control by a single surgeon using standardized phacoemulsification technique and they were kept aphakic. The preoperative intraocular pressure was less than 18 millimeter of mercury. Eyes with the coexisting ocular or systemic anomalies or comorbidities were excluded from this study and those with the less than 6 months follow-up were also excluded. Detailed postoperative examination done at a regular follow-up intervals. And the UBM was done at the end of third month follow-up under anesthesia. And Aviso Quantel was used to see with the 50 and 25 megahertz probe. Outcome measures were anatomical measurement as well as morphological changes of the anterior and posterior chamber structures. The anterior chamber angle AOD at 500 micron, then trabecular ciliary process distance, TCPD, as well as iris ciliary process distance, that is sulcus ciliaris, were calculated using this machine. The demographic profile of the both the groups was identical, except axial length, according to our study design. At the end of 5 years follow-up, the microphthalmic eyes, 31.4% eyes had a high intraocular pressure compared to the non-microphthalmic eyes, which was 12%. The table is showing you the UBM quantitative parameters, and it is seen that sulcus ciliaris, that is ICPD, as well as internal angle width was significantly less in the microphthalmic eyes because this could be explained with the short axial length of the microphthalmic eyes. This picture is that of a UBM picture of non-microphthalmic eyes with the normal IOP. You see that the chamber is well developed, angle is wide open, iris structure is normal, ciliary processes are normal, as well as good sulcus distance. Abnormal morphological features like ciliary body insertion posterior to the iris surface, elongated ciliary processes, high iris insertion, iris hypoplasia, and flat pars plicata were morphologically significantly different in microphthalmic eyes compared to the controls. Elongated ciliary processes are finger-like projection. They are oriented parallel to the posterior surface or iris and appear to be aberrantly inserted into the posterior surface of the iris as shown in this picture. And surprisingly, none of the normal eyes had this abnormal morphology, while microphthalmic eyes with the high intraocular pressure, it was seen in 81.8%, which was statistically significant. The ciliary body insertion on the posterior iris surface was another feature which was commonly seen with the microphthalmic eyes with the high intraocular pressure, statistically significant. And high iris insertion was seen in almost all microphthalmic eyes, but 72% of such eyes had high intraocular pressure. Iris hypoplasia is well shown in these two pictures. Almost all the microphthalmic eyes had a mild developed iris, and 72.7% had high IOP in microphthalmic eyes. This is flat pars plicata. We have seen it for the first time in the microphthalmic eyes in 54%, not very significantly high, but it was something abnormal that also we found out with this eyes. So to summarize, the abnormal morphological features of microphthalmic eyes, when they compared with the eyes with the raised IOP compared to the normal IOP, the alter morphology appears to be a high risk factor for the development of high intraocular pressure. When we survey the literature, only one study we could find which suggests that the presence of elongated ciliary process in phakic eye with the congenital glaucoma can be there, and they suggested stretching mechanism. But our eyes were aphakic and short axial lens, so stretching mechanism is not applicable. The abnormalities of the ciliary body have been described by Gupta et al., and it was described in congenital glaucoma with longer axial length, which was also not like what we had. Other abnormalities that I have described are not described in the literature so far. So to conclude, ciliary body developmental abnormalities such as elongated ciliary processes, abnormal insertion of iris and ciliary body, flat pars plicata are more common in microphthalmic eyes with congenital cataract, and such eyes are susceptible to develop rise in IOP after cataract surgery. It is our limitation to explain why this patient has not shown high IOP before surgery. How to implicate the knowledge? We can have a better planning treatment option, and we defer secondary IOL or sulcur fixated IOL in such eyes with the abnormal anatomy. And it is helpful to counsel the parents regarding the bad prognosis and lifetime follow-up in this child. Thank you.
So, Dr. Mayuri, is it a standard practice in your hospital that you do an UBM after four months?
Yes, sir.
Following pediatric cataracts?
Yes, sir.
Before you implant or secondary
sir,
implant?
Unfortunately, this study, we could not do preoperative UBM because in small children to have a UA frequently is not possible because of anesthesia risk. So it was done postoperatively after 3 months in all the eyes.
No, I was just wondering, like, is it the UBM under UA was done because you were planning a secondary implant, or was it done only
as a follow-up, because intraocular pressure measurement is also not possible with the small babies. So we do short UA with the minimum anesthetic agent used, and it is done in after 3 months in all our patients. It may be a microphthalmic or a normal eyes.
Yeah, means the preoperative and postoperative comparison would have been much more
Yes, sir, I do agree with that.
Whether there are any anatomical changes are there.
Yes.
Preoperatively, which are changing or non-changing. That is one group can form, which will form the high-risk group.
Yes, sir. That is what we suggested from this study, that we should have seen preoperatively also. And nowadays, we are... Thank you, sir.
Now I call upon Dr. Swati Kalki. Best paper from Telangana State Ophthalmological Society is the
It is recombinant interferon alpha 2b for OSSN, an efficient and cost-effective treatment modality for Asian Indian patients.
A very good morning to all. So I'll be presenting about the use of interferon alpha 2b in ocular surface squamous neoplasia. I do not have any financial interest to disclose. Now, ocular surface squamous neoplasia, it can present in various forms where it can be a very small lesion or it can be a large lesion or covering the entire ocular surface. There are various treatment options to treat this condition. It ranges from wide excision biopsy to topical treatment to radiation treatment or surgeries like enucleation and orbital excentration depending upon the severity of the disease. The use of interferon alpha 2b for ocular surface squamous neoplasia was first reported in 1994 by Maskin et al., where they reported a case for which they used interferon alpha 2b and which showed good response to treatment. Since then, there have been various reports from the West where they have used interferon alpha 2b for ocular surface squamous neoplasia. However, there have not been many reports from India. Interferon alpha 2b is a protein molecule which inhibits viruses, activates immunocompetent cells and regulates oncogenes and thus causing tumor regression. It can be used as topical medication where it is used at a dose of 1 million international units per cc, or it can be given as subconjunctival or perilesional injection at a dose of 3 to 10 million international units per cc. It is commercially available. The most commonly available is Interferon A, which costs about 15,000 rupees, which is $225. So in Indian scenario, if we have to use this particular medication and for a period of 6 months treatment, it would cost about 1 lakh per patient. So the purpose of our study was to use interferon alpha 2b, which is manufactured in India, and analyze its cost effectiveness. It was conducted as a prospective study after attaining IRB approval from the Institutional Review Board at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. The study duration was from August 2013 to December 2015. Ocular surface squamous neoplasia, which were diffuse, which was defined as more than 6 clock hours of limbus or involving 50% of the ocular surface, and which were plecoid, that is less than 3 millimeters in thickness, were included in this study, and they had to have a minimum follow-up of 6 months. The exclusion criteria were if it was a very small lesion, which could be excised, or invasive tumors, or with intraocular or orbital extension, or had a follow-up less than 6 months, were excluded in this study. The interferon alpha 2b, which was used in the study, was this particular one, where it costs less than 1,000 rupees per vial. For the corneal OSSN, only the topical medication was used, and for this, the medication was freshly reconstituted in the clinic by reconstituting with distilled water, by adding the drug and adding the adequate amount of distilled water so that the concentration is 1 million international units per cc. And for conjunctival lesion, a combination of both the topical medication and perilesional injection was used. Here, the injection was injected such that it causes ballooning of the conjunctiva around the lesion. A total of 30 patients were included with a mean age at presentation of 55 years. The mean tumor basal diameter was 16 millimeters and mean number of limbal clock hours involved were 6. Complete tumor regression with the use of interferon alpha 2b alone was seen in 93% of the cases. However, in 7% of the cases, there was residual tumor for which subsequent excision biopsy was performed. The number of cycles which needed were for complete tumor regression were 3 cycles, but we always give 3 more cycles after complete regression of the tumor. So the total number of cycles that were given were 6 cycles, and the total cost including the 3 cycles of topical interferon after complete tumor regression was approximately rupees 10,000. The side effects was the conjunctival hyperemia was seen in about 13% of the cases and flu-like symptoms in 8%. And these are some of the examples where before treatment you can see a lesion which completely regressed with treatment. And this is a corneal lesion which completely regressed with topical interferon. And this is a conjunctival lesion extending onto the limbus and the cornea where there was complete regression with interferon. This is one more where there was complete regression with interferon. Thus, we conclude that interferon alpha 2b is effective in the treatment of ocular surface squamous neoplasia. And in Indian scenario, we can use this interferon alpha 2b, which is locally available and the cost of which is less than 10,000 per patient for the entire course of treatment. Thank you.
Did you compare the group with standard interferon alpha with Indian-made?
We did not, so the intron, if the standard one, the intron 8 is very expensive. It is like 1 lakh per patient.
What?
Sorry?
No, no, the efficacy is comparable or not. When if there is a comparative group, you can derive it better. That's what I'm asking.
We compared it with only the published literature. The published literature is mainly from two groups. That's the Shields group and at Baskin Palmer where they do. The success rates were comparable when we use this medication as well. The success rates were comparable.
Historical.
That type of comparison has been described.
Sorry?
Historical.
Historical comparison.
Yeah.
Now, that type of comparison has been described, I asked you.
Not with the Indian patients and the US. It is only in the literature what we have studied.
We sometimes compare what is called as historical comparison. We don't know. We haven't done. So we compare sometimes to what is available in the literature. Only difficulty with this is there are different groups of patients.
Yes.
So that may not be applicable in all cases.
Yes.
Okay. Nevertheless.
What's the chemical difference, chemical composition difference between the costly drug and the Indian drug?
When we spoke to the pharmaceutical company and also the composition, what they had given, it was similar. Probably it is only because it's a different because what is available in the US is from Merck. And probably it's only the company that made the that it's different. And also the concentration is slightly different. Intron A is available as 10 million international units, and this is 5 million international units.
It's already in clinical practice, I think.
In yes.
Only you have compared and effectiveness is proved in a study.
Yes. In India, somehow we haven't, only because of the cost factor, we were not using it much. So that is why we wanted to study if it is effective.
When has this drug been available in the Indian market?
I suppose this has been always been available because this is used for other conditions, like they use it for other cancers. Interferon. So it has, I did not ask the company from when it is available, but they mentioned that this has been always used by the general oncologists. But somehow we have not tried that drug for using in ophthalmology, and that's what we tried to do with this.
Right.
It is available, and I think she has, I don't think we are entertaining questions from floor. He is past president, has no vested interest in any of the presentations. That's why we allowed him.
He has some advantages of being past president.
Yeah.
No, and Dr. Kuresh has been always a Rangachari judge for the last I don't remember how many years. So
thank you.
We always take his help.
Now I call upon Dr. Gupta, VP Gupta. Is he there? He was not there even before, so we'll proceed to the next presentation. Dr. Goyal JL. Not there again. So Dr. Suryanath. His presentation is time domain anti-segment optical coherence tomography in ocular surface squamous cell neoplasia.
Good morning to all. I have no financial disclosures. Ocular surface squamous neoplasia, abbreviated commonly as OSSN, the treatment modality of this entity has seen a paradigm shift from surgical excision in the previous era to immunotherapy and chemotherapy. There is a need and there is a search for newer non-invasive techniques that can help in the diagnosis and management. Let's look at this case, who was a 65-year-old female who had a multifocal lesion both on the bulbar and the palpable conjunctiva. She was subjected to an anterosegment OCT at points shown in the yellow dashed line. And what we find is an epithelial thickening, an abrupt transition, and hyperreflectivity shown by a white arrow in the bottom left picture. What we also saw on the palpable lesion was there was a basal membrane and there was also a clear plane of separation that was seen, and this particular lesion came out to be an intraepithelial neoplasia. The purpose of our study was to correlate the imaging characteristics of OSSN on a commercially available time domain anterosegment OCT with the histopathology, which is the gold standard, find out and derive characteristics which can help differentiate an OSSN from pterygium, differentiate invasive from intraepithelial neoplasia, and find its relevance in surveillance. This was a prospective study approved by the Institutional Ethics Committee that ran over 2 years. And we had included patients who were clinically diagnosed as OSSN or pterygia who consented both for surgery and imaging. There were 21 patients in the OSSN group, and there were 10 patients in the pterygium group, and the mean ages were comparable. Patient 1 had a gelatinous lesion in the limbus, which was seen, and showed that typical epithelial thickening, the abrupt transition, and the hyperreflectivity, and that is shown as a white arrow in the middle scan. And this patient, on histopathology, showed a full thickness, faulty maturational sequence, suggestive of severe dysplasia. When we did the same corneal scan protocol on a patient with pterygium shown on the bottom row, this patient did not show the epithelial thickening, it did not show the abrupt transition, and the hyperreflectivity, though present, seemed to be subepithelial, and this was consistent in all patients who had pterygia. Another patient who had a typical OSSN, we subjected this patient to antrosegment OCT, and here we found the other characteristics we talk about. In addition, we found there was a basal membrane shown by a yellow triangle. And this, on histopathology, corresponded to a strong desmoplastic response that was seen at the junction of the epithelium and the stroma. This was probably corresponding to the basal membrane that we saw. This patient also showed a focal area of invasion. Now, we had 6 patients who had varying degrees of dysplasia. 4 out of these showed the clear plane, and 3 of them showed the basal membrane that we talked about. Another patient who had a suspicious-looking lesion, and in addition to the epithelial thickening that was present, what was absent was the clear plane, and that was probably because of the back shadowing. On a histopathology, on low and high magnification, there was a squamous metaplasia, and there was dense actinic response in the stroma, and this was probably why the clear plane was missing here. We had 5 patients, 3 of whom had carcinoma in situ, and 2 had actinic keratosis. All the patients who had carcinoma in situ had both the clear plane and the basal membrane. And the ones who had actinic keratosis had an absent clear plane, as we described earlier. This was a small lesion, and here we found that there was a basal membrane, but again, an absence of clear plane. And that was probably, again, because of the histopathologically seen actinic changes in the stroma. Case 5 was a large lesion, which on subjected to the antrosegment OCT showed a hyperreflectivity, and this showed a clear plane, but on higher sections, you see a lot of shadowing. What was also seen, a hyporeflective patch, which seemed to correspond to stromal pockets seen on the histopathology and shown as a black triangle. This was invasive SCC. And a very similar patient, again, who had invasive SCC, also showed the same features. We had 6 patients of invasive squamous cell carcinoma, and many of them, at a thickness of more than 1 to 1.4 millimeters, the shadowing was so much that it was difficult to make any resolution and other characteristics. Case 6 had a leukoplakic lesion, and though there was a hyperreflectivity, the thickening was absent and also showed an absence of the clear plane. This was probably because of the leukoplakic lesion of OSSN. Finally, patient 7 is a patient who had a large lesion along of 6 clocars of the limbus. He refused primary surgery. He underwent serial sections, optical sections with the antrosegment OCT, and underwent monthly cycles of interferon. Over a period of time, we found that these sections taken nasally and inferior limbus showed a dramatic change which corresponded with the TDAS OCT. To conclude, a custom designed ultra high resolution OCT has a proven role. What we found for the first time was a commercially available time-domain antrosegment OCT had a good correlation in intraneoplastic lesions. What was also was a hyperreflective basal layer was described for the first time and seemed to correspond with the intraepithelial neoplasia. It also seems to have a role in surveillance of OSSN. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Suryana. In this, you have included 21 patients.
That's
out
right.
Of which some are very clear-cut cases of OSSN.
That's right.
Would you have included only cases which are borderline cases of OSSN and then compare the OCT changes?
As I mentioned, I think the idea was because, as I mentioned, the custom-designed machine, which is the ultra-high-resolution machine, has seemed to have, over several reports, shown that you can differentiate OSSN. Our idea was to find out a machine which is available in most clinics and find, number one, to differentiate OSSN from benign lesions. That is easy. And what we found that this was not very difficult. The characteristics that they talked about in the ultra-high resolution machine are seen even in the commercial machine. But what was an audacious goal was to find out if we can differentiate an invasive disease from intraepithelial disease. And we found that the resolution, and because of the massive shadowing that you see in large lesions, though you find there is thickening, but the resolution or the shadow does not allow enough image characteristics where you can really characterize.
Yeah.
The new thing was the basal layer.
Yeah, if you see the one of the massive growth of the OSSN, there the shadowing effect will be there and it will totally obscure the image. That's where you cannot conclude, and some cases you may find it is negative on OCT. It's a great idea to compare, because instead of getting every case a histopathological sample, you can see the OCT and these findings. If they are negative, you can just follow up, and otherwise you can subject to histopathological examination.
That's right.
However, the group which, if you have selected a borderline cases, probably that would have been given you a much more better understanding about the disease process. Right. Thank you,
nice.
Sir. Now we'll move on to the next presenter, Dr. Kalyani Deshpande. Is she around? Dr. Kalyani Deshpande, she is not there. You are Dr. Kalyani? No, that's not her. She is coming, so we will ask her to present later. Then is Dr. Roshmi Gupta. She has come. Please, Dr. Kalyani Deshpande. Her topic is Bowman's imaging, a novel imaging marker for detection of keratoconus.
A very good morning, everyone. Me and my co-authors have no financial disclosures. So to begin, since the 1950s, the Bowman's layer has been extensively studied using electron microscopy and histopathologic studies, and defects such as breaks in the Bowman's layer, lattice-like configuration, and ruptures in the Bowman's layer with collagenous scar tissues have been detected. But this is of no relevance to the clinician as long as we cannot study this in a living patient. So considering another imaging modality, which is the high-resolution OCT by Bioptigen, which is a handheld device. On the left, we can see that the Bowman's layer is a very smooth surface with any irregularities, whereas on the right is the Bowman's layer, which has undulations and microdistortions. So the question that we asked was, can microdistortions have any diagnostic implications? The purpose of our study was to quantify the irregularity of the Bowman's layer in keratoconus and form-thrust keratoconus using high-resolution OCT. 82 eyes of 61 patients were included in our study. 30 were normal eyes, 21 eyes had FFKC, and 31 eyes were those of frank keratoconus. FFKC eyes were the clinically normal fellow eyes of patients of keratoconus. Imaging was performed using a standard protocol. The central 3 millimeters of the cornea was used for scanning, and the resolution obtained on the OCT was a 3 micron of lateral resolution and an axial resolution of close to 2 microns. So what is the Bowman's roughness index, or the BRI? The microdistortions are seen in this image as marked by the red arrows. The line in yellow is the detected Bowman's layer. Another smooth line fit on this is the line in blue. Zooming in this image, you can see that there are certain areas enclosed in between the two lines, and the sum total of these microdistortion zones gives us the BRI in millimeters square. Thinning of the Bowman's layer precedes formation of breaks, which is why we need to detect BRI in its early stage. From the graph on the right, we can see that the BRI was highest in normal eyes and was lowest in eyes with keratoconus. This is a tabular representation of the same data, and we can see that BRI, when compared to other indices obtained from the Pentacam, Galilee, and the OPSCan, fared very well in detecting disease from normal eyes. Focusing on the left half of the table here, we can see that the BRI was having a high sensitivity than the BAD-D index, which is the current gold standard obtained from the Pentacam. And it detects form fresh keratoconus better as compared to the other indices. When these two indices were combined, we could see that the sensitivity and specificity improved to as high as 80 and 90% in detecting early disease. So the question is, with so many available tools in the market, do we actually need another scan and another index? The answer is yes, because these modalities do not take into account the confounding effect of the epithelium. As we can see from these two images, that the Bowman's layer has breaks and undulations which are very easily masked by the overlying epithelium, and this is not taken into account even by Scheimpflug imaging today. So taking a step further, the Bowman's layer obtained from the OCT was actually used to derive a topography. So lower half of the slide shows us three images. The leftmost image is topography obtained from the Pentacam. The second image is topography obtained from the air to epithelium interface, and the rightmost is topography from the true Bowman's layer, that is the epithelium to the Bowman's layer interface. And there is a very significant difference of close to 2 diopters in the maximum keratometry, which was completely missed on the Pentacam. Another interesting slide where we can see that an area of suspicious inferior steepening on the Pentacam actually changed to regular with the rule astigmatism when topography was performed using the OCT at the layer of the level of the Bowman's layer. So the translational relevance of detecting FFKC is it will help preventing ectasias when LASIK will not be performed in such eyes, and it will reduce the total burden of corneal transplants. It is also relevant in detecting true progression and regression, in detecting the disease at an early stage, in customized cross-linking, and in surface ablations. Certain other indices such as the Bowman's Ectasia Index have also been studied by Dr. Sonia Yu et al. But the drawback of this study is that they included only eyes with frank keratoconus, and the relevance of detecting this index in eyes with FFKC is yet to be studied so far. So to conclude, BRI is significantly altered in FFKC eyes. Morphological changes tend to occur before topographic manifestations, and the translational aspect is that this index can possibly be incorporated in our future OCT machines. So what was known so far is that the epithelial masks underlying stromal irregularities. What our study adds is a non-invasive method of measuring topography at the level of Bowman's layer, and BRI is an index that may bring about a paradigm shift in the way keratoconus is currently detected. Thank you.
So, did you say something about topography from a OCT?
Yes, sir.
How is it that?
A special software called MathGraph, sir. These images are acquired by the OCT and exported. And as I showed you earlier, that the Bowman's layer has to be marked. So, just like in the Pentacam, we need a reference surface. So, a reference line is a third order polynomial, which is a smooth curve. So, any areas below and above that are calculated as elevation and areas of steepening or flattening, just similar to the Pentacam, but it is the OCT image that is acquired, and then this calculation is performed. The software is called MathGraph.
So is it something that your institute?
No, sir. It's commercially available. It's not developed by us.
Do you know anything about
it? We don't know, but it's newer, this thing. At least the images are showing abnormality below the Bowman's. Actually, two images you have shown. One is there is a real break is there, and one there is a cavity formation, which you have not pointed out there. But no. There is an indication towards keratoconus that probably an early change than the break in the Bowman's.
Yes, sir. So the
only thing is, do you require more larger number of cases to show that it is consistently happening?
Yes, sir. It's an ongoing study. We are looking at collecting more samples.
What do you do in PRK to the Bowman's membrane?
Sir, in PRK...
You do PRK, what happens to the Bowman's membrane?
The Bowman's membrane is ablated, sir. Because
ablated.
Yes, about 50 microns of the epithelium would be removed.
So when the Bowman's membrane is ablated, the keratoconus should appear more rapidly in PRK. If your theory about something wrong with the Bowman's membrane as the primary cause of keratoconus is correct, yes?
Yes.
and it is the confounding factor of epithelium on top of this. If you remove it, it will be more apparent. But when you remove the whole Bowman's membrane, nothing happens.
Sir,
how do you explain that?
So that is because we do not perform PRK in patients who have keratoconus. We are ruling out keratoconus when
no,
we perform.
No, we do perform PRK.
That is always combined with cross-linking.
Yes.
We do not do it as a standalone procedure.
It,
so
it may not be standard treatment, but it is done. LASIK plus or
yes,
these things are done.
So LASIK is...
So how do you explain that?
So, sir, I would again say that PRK will not be performed as a standalone procedure. We always combine with cross-linking. Because of cross-linking, the anterior stroma becomes more compact, and that is how progression is prevented. And the laser itself tends to create more amount of scarring and fibrosis in the anterior stroma, which is more in PRK because the anterior stroma is ablated as compared to LASIK, and that is how progression will probably not occur. But again, not PRK alone, PRK with cross-linking.
Okay.
No, good observation. Don't get discouraged.
It's okay.
You increase the number so that maybe futurely you may be true and he may be wrong. We don't know. Yeah, we'll go for the next talk by Dr. Roshmi Gupta. Yeah, she will be presenting on risk factors for orbital implant exposure after evisceration, a case control study of 93 patients.
Good morning. This is an analytical approach to a very common problem faced by oculoplasty surgeons on a day-to-day basis. The authors have no financial interest. It's very distressing both for the patient and for the surgeon if there's an orbital implant exposure after a relatively straightforward procedure like evisceration with implant. Over the last several years, I've had to treat a significant number of exposed and extruded implants. Now, these are other surgeons' patients. The implants were of materials I almost never use. So were the implants responsible? Or am I missing something and my surgeries are having the same outcome and going elsewhere? Higher exposure risk is known to be associated with oversized implants, unhealthy and scarred conjunctiva, infected ocular contents such as endophthalmitis, porous implants, and poor surgical technique. This teaching comes to us from our teachers, from colleagues who say, oh, so-and-so implant is rubbish, don't use it. Conferences and gut feeling. When we looked at the literature, there are reports explaining implant exposure rates of 5 to 20%. There's a bunch of reports giving outcomes of new implants as and when manufacturers put them into the market. Exposure risk in endophthalmitis has been addressed by some papers, but they give it as 10% to 12%, which comes within the range of exposure of other patients. So instead of looking at exposure rates, we decided to analyze the risk factors for implant exposure. Group A were cases of 32 eyes with implant exposure post-evisceration. Group B were historical controls taken from our database, 61 eyes without implant exposure, all operated between 2010 to 14. These were operated by multiple surgeons ranging from residents and trainees and fellows to general ophthalmologists to trained oculoplasty surgeons. The patients were analyzed for presence of a small scleral shell, as in thysis bulbi, which might lead to a tight scleral closure, large implant diameter, implant material, porous or non-porous, presence of infection, multiple surgeries pre-evisceration, and duration of follow-up. The analysis was planned, and the results showed a mean follow-up in group A of 18 months and in control group of 36 months. The implants included spherical implants of silicone, indigenous porous polyethylene, hydroxyapatite, and aluminium oxide. Mean interval to implant exposure was 20 months. The follow-up of control group was a mean of 37 months, which means there was adequate follow-up of the controls that an exposure would not have been missed. The primary presentation of the implant exposure in more than half the patients was with pain, discharge, or bleeding. When we looked at the average implant diameter in the two groups, that was 19.06 in the exposed group and 18.7 in group B, the control group. So this was not significant. Now here comes the interesting part. including the porous versus non-porous implant, pre-evisceration infection, multiple surgeries, and thyroid bulbi, none of these factors were shown to be significant. We dug a little deeper because there were some anecdotal reports of indigenous porous polyethylene having poor results, and that was also not statistically significant. Okay, then we thought maybe putting a larger implant in a thyroid scleral shell might be significant, but no, not even that. The limitation was that we could not analyze the impact of surgical technique or surgeon factor because there wasn't an uniformity. The average interval to exposure was 20 months. So we would need to know that any outcome reported for any implant is valid only if there's a long-term analysis. More than 50% patients are symptomatic. So alertness will improve early detection of implant exposure. And from the negative results, we get some very interesting conclusion. No particular implant material is responsible, so you don't need to be industry-driven. You choose your implant. Size is not significant, so replace adequate volume without undersizing implant. We can place an implant post-endophthalmitis. That means you don't have to do a second surgery, put a secondary orbital implant. By elimination, we would hypothesize that meticulous surgical technique is the key to reducing implant exposure. Thank you.
How do you know that the surgical technique is meticulous or not in your study?
There are some standardized techniques. At every point of a evisceration surgery, there are certain points that we have to pay attention to. So here the conclusion is by elimination, but meticulous surgical technique includes respect for the conjunctiva
right
and so on.
It may also be right or wrong because it's a retrospective. Right.
That is the one thing we could not analyze for. Thank you.
Any other? No, we are not allowing any questions from the floor. Okay, thank you then. Now I call upon Dr. Bhavana Chavla. The presentation is evaluation of selective intra-arterial chemotherapy for treatment of intraocular retinoblastoma.
Good morning. My paper on evaluation of selective intra-arterial chemotherapy for the treatment of intraocular retinoblastoma. We have no financial interest to disclose. We all know the goals of therapy in retinoblastoma, first and foremost, is to save the life, then save the eye, and then save vision wherever possible. So globe salvage is usually achieved in early intraocular tumors by conventional treatment with systemic chemotherapy and focal therapy. Although there are good outcomes, it can lead to serious toxic side effects. And then there are refractory cases which do not respond to conventional management. So there are newer treatment approaches that are focused on localized drug delivery. And one such novel approach is the selective intraarterial chemotherapy, the SIAC, which delivers targeted chemotherapy to the eye via direct cannulation of the ophthalmic artery. So the aim of our study was to evaluate the efficacy and safety of SIAC in intraocular retinoblastoma. This was a prospective interventional study with prior approval from the ethics committee of our institute. We recruited children from the retinoblastoma clinic who presented to us between 2014 and 15 after taking an informed consent from the parents. The criteria for inclusion was intraocular retinoblastoma that was refractory to systemic chemotherapy. So for recruiting patients, we follow the standard international classification system, and we included cases with group B retinoblastoma that had tumors confined to the retina, those with group C that had localized subretinal or vitreous seeding, and those with group D that had tumors with diffuse seeding. We excluded patients with advanced intraocular group E disease that were treated with upfront enucleation and those with extraocular presentation. After recording the demographic details, we did a detailed examination under anesthesia, particularly the fundus examination to note the tumor size, number, location, presence of seeds. We did baseline red cam documentation in all cases and did a general physical examination, systemic examination, and appropriate investigations. So the procedure of SIAC was carried out in the interventional neuroradiology department under general anesthesia. The ophthalmic artery of the eye to be treated was selectively catheterized via the internal carotid artery. So this is a short video clip showing the SIAC procedure that was done. As you can see, this was all done under fluoroscopic visualization. The femoral artery was punctured on the intended site of treatment. And here you can see the catheter going up. It went up the thoracic aorta, and it has to position itself in the ipsilateral internal carotid artery. After it is positioned in the ipsilateral internal carotid artery, then we have to access the ophthalmic artery. And for that, we have to use microcatheters and microguide wires. And to do this, a selective angiogram of the internal carotid artery is performed to verify the angioanatomy, the vascular supply of the eye, and to verify the placement of the microcatheter. So once we have identified the ophthalmic artery, you can see over here, it is the first branch of the internal carotid artery. Once we have identified that, then we have to place the microcatheter right at the ostium of the ophthalmic artery so that we can ensure targeted drug delivery to the eye. Once this is done and the ophthalmic artery is accessed, then we use melphalan drug, and at that point of time, it is used in a dose of 3 to 5 milligrams, and it is reconstituted in saline. In 30 ml of saline, we dilute it, and then it is pushed over a period of 30 minutes into the ophthalmic artery to ensure targeted drug delivery into the eye. So the patients are kept under observation for some time, and then they are discharged, and then evaluation is done at 3 weeks. The SIAC can be repeated at 4 weeks in case of partial response, and follow-up is at 2 monthly intervals. So the outcome measures of our study were procedural success defined by successful catheterization of the ophthalmic artery, the efficacy of treatment, and safety of treatment defined by systemic and local complications. So 25 eyes in 24 children were studied. There were 13 boys with a mean age of 3.3 years. The distribution was there were 8 eyes in group B, 2 in group C, and 15 in group D. We did a total of 54 sessions and achieved successful cannulation of the ophthalmic artery in 51 of these 54 sessions with a procedural success of 94.4%. As far as the efficacy of treatment was concerned, it was evaluated in 23 eyes. That is, in 2 eyes, we were not able to access the ophthalmic artery. The overall efficacy was 65.2% defined by regression of tumor. It was best in group B and worst in group D, that was advanced disease. This is an example, a red cam picture of refractory retinoblastoma after 6 cycles of chemotherapy. The tumor had not responded. After 2 shots of SIAC, we had a nice type 3 regression pattern with a calcified scar of fish flesh appearance and flat chorioretinal scar. This is another example of a child refractory to 8 cycles of systemic chemotherapy. Again, after 2 cycles of SIAC, it had regressed into a calcified mass. An example to show how SIAC was effective in multiple tumors. The 2 tumors at the top you can see had responded to chemotherapy, but the one below had not, was still active and responded after 1 shot of SIAC. There were no major systemic complications such as thromboembolic phenomena, sepsis, neutropenia. We encountered ophthalmic artery vasospasm in 2 cases, skin pigmentation and alopecia in 1 case, which was transient and self-limiting. Ocular complications were few, ptosis, which was hemorrhage and redness of eye, and resolved with time. So to summarize, this was a prospective interventional study on 25 eyes with refractory retinoblastoma with a procedural success of 94.4%, a tumor control rate of 65.2%, no major systemic complications, and only transient ocular complications. So we conclude from this is that SIAC is effective after treatment failure of intravenous chemotherapy and focal therapy in retinoblastoma eyes otherwise destined for enucleation. Careful case selection and a multidisciplinary team are important considerations. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much. Normally, when we alter the treatment, we try to see if we can simplify the treatment. This is the first time you have complicated the treatment. One, ophthalmologist cannot do. Yes. Two, you need to have a full-fledged radiology department. And cannulating the ophthalmic artery is not always 100% successful, correct?
Yes.
And there are complications associated with puncturing femoral artery. Yes? And the cost increases. Yes? So why do you suggest that this should be done?
So because these were eyes that were otherwise destined for enucleation. And the other thing was that there was evidence in the literature. In the West, it has been used. And there was evidence to show that the globe salvage can be
achieved with this treatment. So, of course, we need a multidisciplinary team, but if the patients can be given this option, then it should be considered before going ahead with enucleation.
What's the evidence in literature?
Yes, sir. So it is basically, this was work was pioneered by Dr. David Abramson at New York, this technique of intraarterial chemotherapy. And the first report came out in 2011, and they have achieved globe salvage rates between 55 to 100% in such refractory cases of retinoblastoma. In fact, now it has the treatment has been standardized to such an extent that they are even using it as primary treatment. But we did not use it as primary treatment because in our setting, it was the first time that we were doing something like this. So we only used it for those cases of refractory retinoblastoma that were otherwise destined for enucleation. And now that we have also achieved reasonably good rates of tumor control without such complications.
How many cases did you do and what was the salvage?
Yes, sir. So we had 25 eyes, and in that we were able to assess the efficacy in only 23 eyes because in 2 eyes we had to abandon the procedure. The ophthalmic artery could not be accessed. In those 23 eyes, sir, we had a globe salvage rate of 65.2%. 15 out of those 23 eyes could be salvaged, depending upon whether they were group C, B, C, or D. We took 3 different levels within the intraocular group. We did not treat group E because they are treated with upfront enucleation. They are not given a trial of systemic chemotherapy. These were only those cases that were given a trial of chemotherapy. They had failed chemotherapy, and that is when we applied this technique.
You said that you put these patients, the refractory patients.
Yes.
Now, well, how much time interval did you actually give between...
Yes, sir. So they were all treated with a minimum
of... First chemotherapy and this one.
So actually, sir, they were all treated with a minimum of 6 cycles of systemic chemotherapy, which is the standard protocol that we use for intraocular retinoblastoma. So 6 cycles, after 6 cycles of chemotherapy, if the tumor was still active, those cases were the ones which we treated through this intraarterial route.
Could you also assign that maybe somewhat delayed effect of the previous chemotherapy?
Not really, sir, because because they were actually progressing while on chemotherapy. So
right.
That is why, yeah, we could not attribute it to the delayed effects of systemic chemotherapy.
That's what AIMS is all about, right?
Yes. Thank you.
Good. Yeah, now, is Dr. Shruti Kochhar is
yes,
so she will be presenting on topo-guided cross-linking outcome study and its relationship to cellular biomarkers.
Good morning. I'm presenting a study on topography-guided cross-linking and its relationship to cellular biomarkers. I have no financial interest to disclose. Corneal cross-linking is still not 100% complication-free. So the research question we proposed was, can we customize our cross-linking? Should we treat cones in the keratoconic corneas differently? And is there a correlation between outcomes of cross-linking to cellular biomarkers? We tried to answer all these questions using this study model. Coming to the first arm, why should we customize? Cross-linking is a pretty safe procedure, but the results can be variable. To understand this unpredictability, we undertook this study. We looked back into the molecular mechanisms of keratoconus, and from this published paper, we know that inflammatory mediators are elevated in the epithelium of the cone area, which means possibly keratoconus is inflammatory and it is probably a localized disease. Since all these factors are expressed into the epithelium and tear film, we thought that this will be good biological samples to assess the homeostasis, that is, behavior of cornea. With newer advances like Brillio microscopy, it has been shown that cone and periphery have different biomechanical profiles. So when we combine both of these studies, we can infer that the biomechanical profile and molecular signature are probably different in the cone area. So why not selectively cross-link just the diseased zone? Because this may provide better outcome and also minimize the collateral damage. Next is the methodology of the study. We conducted a prospective study which included a total of 35 patients, out of which 20 underwent standard accelerated cross-linking using 9 milliwatts per centimeter square for 10 minutes. Another 15 patients underwent customized cross-linking, that is KXL2. We analyzed all the parameters before surgery and assessed them till 1 year. Based on the change in corneal flattening, we classified the outcomes as positive, that is optimal or suboptimal. Images were acquired from Pentacam and transported to KXL2 machine using a pen drive. Manufacturer recommended sector-based UV beam profile was used and treatment was planned. Iris tracking is the added advantage of this machine. As a clinician, the most important concern of differential beam is high energy. So this is the schematic diagram of the UVA beam profile used in our protocol. As you can see, the maximum energy used in zone 1, that is the area of cone, did not exceed 15 joule per centimeter square. And according to safety guidelines, anything less than 19 is safe. So it is not hazardous to limbal stem cells. The clinical safety profile was within normal limits, specular findings were comparable, and the biomechanics also improved, although not statistically significant. Two-way ANOVA analysis was performed amongst the surgical outcomes and the type of surgery. K2, that is steep keratometry, showed significant reduction in the optimal group. Interestingly, 70% of the cases undergoing routine KXL and 80% of the cases undergoing customized KXL showed positive outcome. The outcome like demarcation line in both the groups were comparable, and the topography was also stable and comparable. Now coming to the next arm, why this cell biology? Why is it important to assess biomarkers? Because the outcome of cross-linking may be determined by the basal inflammation, collagen, and the cellular components. In our study, we collected epithelium and sent it separately, cone and periphery, to the lab. After RNA extraction and polymerase chain reaction, the ratio of gene expression was studied. The results were like, in our study, lysyl oxidase, that is LOX, natural cross-linking enzyme, was significantly upregulated in positive outcomes in both the groups. Also, TIMPs, collagen 4, which is a structural protein, and BMP7 followed a similar trend. Coming back to the original question, yes, we can customize the cross-linking according to the topography. We observed a significant improvement in the visual acuity and corneal flattening after our protocol. Clinical and demographic matrix were mostly similar between both the groups, and the outcomes correlated well to the cellular biomarkers. I believe in differential beam cross-linking because a combination of clinical knowledge, cell biology, and advanced imaging. In near future, we will be able to demarcate the area of cone better and have more accurate beam profile. So what this study adds new is that customized cross-linking is novel and safe approach. Differential molecular signatures may affect the outcomes of cross-linking, but since we cannot use epithelium preoperatively to assess these factors, tear measurement of LOX and collagen can be a good surrogate measure to predict the outcome of cross-linking. Thank you so much.
Did you find that this epithelium is abnormal only after this study, and you felt that tears would have given you better biomarkers?
Epithelium cannot be assessed preoperatively. We are looking at the...
No. Please, I understand. I understand your proposition that we cannot de-epithelize preoperatively. Okay. Yes. Did you come to the conclusion that the tears analysis of biomarkers only after this study or before you
we
did
thought
of
We have been doing this for quite some time for other conditions as well, like dry eye. We've done it for keratoconus before this. So this is just a future continuation of the previous project.
In your place, I would have thought of tear biomarker analysis first compared to the epithelial biomarker analysis. What is your comment about it?
We do both the analysis, sir, since epithelium was also collected. And this is the exact first-hand sample, because tear gets diluted by many other factors, meibomian secretions, and there are so many factors. We give drops. All these factors can affect slightly the analysis of the tears. So epithelium would be a better sample, if at all available, compared to tears.
Did you compare both?
For this study, no, sir, we did not.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Which place was this study from?
Bangalore, sir.
There was one more study showing some abnormality with the epithelium in KC.
I think we will not go into that.
Thank you, sir.
Can I have Dr. Jitendra Jithani? He will be presenting on stability and effects of muscle transfer. I said he
only. Heard it wrong.
Yeah. Stability and effects of muscle transplantation for large angle esotropia, a study of 22 patients. Dr. Jitendra.
Good morning, judges. We have no financial disclosures to make. So we all know that a very large angle, such as this, larger than 80% diopters, cannot be treated with a single eye surgery, and it cannot correct such a large angle. So supramaximal recessions and resections would lead to restriction of ocular motility. Muscle transplantation has been known to augment the surgical results. We present our series of 22 patients with large angle esotropia, which were treated with muscle transplantation. This was a prospective interventional study. A total of 22 patients were included in the study. The inclusion criteria was a minimum of 80 prisms base out angle in primary position. All the patients underwent thorough preoperative orthoptic checkup and refraction. So this was the surgical technique. And so this was the surgery starts with a normal muscle separation of medial rectus, as you can see. And we are tying 6-O-proline here, the non-absorbable suture. And then we move on to the lateral rectus, which is separated. And two pairs of 6-O-vicryl are tied at the insertion and at the desired point of resection. So that is 8 millimeters in this particular surgery. So once you do the resection, you advance the muscle, you get this stump, which will be separated. Now this stump normally would be thrown off in a normal resection technique. Whereas here it is transplanted, or rather anastomosed or grafted on the normal medial rectus with 6-O-proline, which was already tied there. And then once you anastomose this, you can do a normal recession as you would normally do, which is in this case was around 5.5 millimeters, which is the maximum amount of medial rectus recession which we do. So the patients were followed up for the evaluation at day 1, 36 months, and 1 year and 2 years. An angle was measured post-operatively, and ocular movements were also recorded. Now the mean age was 32 years. The mean pre-operative angle was around 92.4 prism diopters. That's a huge angle. And the mean post-operative angle at 2 years follow-up was 12.3 prism diopters. So you can the best advantage of this surgery is you can see in the lower photographs, you can see that the ocular motility is not restricted despite doing such a large angle correction. This is another post-operative patient, and this is another post-operative patient. So the average correction per millimeter was around 4.1 prism diopters. The adduction restriction, which you would normally would be huge if you correct such a large angle, was less than minus 1 in all the patients except one of the patients at the end of 1 year and at the end of 2 years. The abduction was obviously normal. Now, such large angles, more than 50 to 55 prisms, we all know cannot be treated with a single eye surgery. And cases where we are forced to do single eye surgery in amblyopic eyes or partially recovered palsy eyes, we have to operate both the eyes. So if we are forced to operate one of the eyes, this is one of the very good procedures. The earliest muscle transplantation was described in 1973, which was mainly in chickens. And this was followed by two small case series of three cases. So how does it work is normally the question which is thought. The muscle transplantation or muscle grafting, as we can call it, basically elongates the muscle and thereby increases the effective length of the muscle, which reduces the per millimeter muscle tension of the medial rectus. And the muscle strength is basically the resected portion of the antagonist muscle. So this is another patient of our series. You can see the wonderful ocular motility post-op. You can see the left eye adduction is very good even post-surgery when we do the surgery. And this is different from supramaximal recession as we would normally be doing in such cases, because this does not go beyond the anatomical and the surgical equator and thereby gives excellent motility options post-surgery. And so this is also different from putting a band or leaving a sleeve between the true muscle and the insertion, because that will have a risk of extrusion. So we conclude by saying that true muscle transplantation is a safe alternate option for large angle esotropia when uniocular surgery is desired, and the surgical results are optimal and safe and stable even in a long term, and hence it is a viable option when we are forced to do a single muscle surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, Jitendra.
Yes, sir.
Did you do MRI in this patient?
No, sir.
No. How did you rule out ocular dystopia as the cause of this large angle?
They were all committent deviations, sir. They were, most of them were committent deviations. There was no, large angle esotropia, they were mostly infantile esotropes. I mean, most of them, there was no suspicion for dystopia, so we did not do MRI. One of the patients had strabismus fixus. In that, we did a CT scan. We presented that as a case report in IGO, which was the third patient. That patient had, we did a loop myopexy along with muscle transplantation. So that was one patient we did image.
In large angle esotropias with certain amount of motility restriction.
None of them had, except that one patient.
Yeah.
Yes.
If there is motility restriction, you
we should do. Yes,
suggest
we imaged
an MRI in these patients.
Yeah, we did image one of the patients.
Now, this is nothing new.
No, this has been published, but long-term results and very small reports. Only three reports were published before.
I can never do this because I never resect the muscle.
Yeah, but if there's a very large angle, and motility restriction is the most important thing. I feel that makes all the difference. If you keep on recessing too much, there would be, in the end, there would be a motility restriction, though we will get a good correction in primary position.
Correct. Normally, they describe recession first and the resection later.
Yeah, but if there's a unilateral case, a patient wants a unilateral surgery, I mean.
Okay. Now, I'm telling you some of the drawbacks of this technique.
True, sir.
So, you have to do resection first. So, you have to be 100% careful before you do this surgery.
No, you have to do resection first. You have to tie 6-O-proline. You mean at the two-stage surgery or you saying?
When you take the muscle piece from one side to put it onto the other side, you do the resection first.
We still do the resection first, as you would normally do. Mm. We tie 6-O-proline there, leave it like that, go to resection. Okay. So we follow the same principles of...
What Amitava described was he did the resection first.
Amitava sir had described that, but we did resection first, okay. Tied 6-O-proline.
Okay. Yeah. Any questions?
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you,
Jitin.
Thank you.
Yeah, now I call upon Dr. Sneha Batra. She will be presenting on the lines of vision, correlation of visual acuity with ISOS junction and ELM integrity in blunt trauma patients.
Good morning, everyone. I'm here to present my paper on the lines of vision, a study on the correlation of visual acuity with ISOS junction and ELM integrity in blunt trauma patients. So at the outset, I would like to describe what are these lines of vision. What are these lines in the OCT which we have described as the lines of vision in my study? So basically with the advancements in technology, the newer HD OCT machines have been able to give us a beautiful resolution of the anatomy of the retina, which we were unable to discern before. As can be seen from this picture, somewhere in the middle, we can see four horizontal lines from outside inwards. They are the retinal pigment epithelium, the cost line or the cone outer segment tip, the ISOS junction line, and the external limiting membrane line. So these hyperreflective horizontal lines seen on a macular scan on OCT, the breach of which have a negative impact on the visual function of the eye, are what I have termed as the lines of vision in the study. So the aim of our study was to evaluate the relationship between the visual acuity and the changes in the ISOS junction and the external limiting membrane in the foveal region in blunt trauma patients. Coming to our methodology, ours was a prospective observational study done at a tertiary apex institute in Jharkhand over a period of 11 months. We included all those patients who came to our OPD with a history of blunt trauma and a GCS of 15/15 and excluded those patients who had any previous history of intraocular surgery, any media opacity, any pre-existing ophthalmological diseases or any systemic diseases which could affect the eye. We obtained a detailed informed consent in the patient's own language and a thorough ophthalmological evaluation was done for each eye under the study, and the entire examination was repeated at 1 month post-trauma. Next, an OCT was obtained by the Zeiss spectral domain OCT machine, and that was also repeated at 1 month post-trauma. Now, we divided the patients into three groups depending on the integrity of the line of the vision. It was called maintained if there was no discontinuity seen,
doubtful if the discontinuity was less than 100 microns, and breached if there was a definite discontinuity more than 100 microns. Statistical evaluation was done by the SPSS software, and ANOVA test was used to perform the test of significance. A total of 38 eyes of 35 subjects were enrolled. This is the demographic profile as can be expected from any study in blunt trauma. Maximum number of patients were in the 20 to 40 years of age group, and more males than females were present. Now coming to our results, we can see that as the integrity of the line of vision went on decreasing, the visual acuity in the logMAR scale is increasing, which is basically the reciprocal of the visual acuity as we know in the Snellens. And the p-value came out to be highly significant in both the groups. This is the graphical representation for the ISOS junction, and this is the one for the ELN. And there was a high correlation between the two groups, the R factor being 0.881. So just to discuss a few representative cases, this was a 33-year-old female with a history of road traffic accident and trauma in the left eye. The visual acuity at presentation was counting finger at 2 feet with presence of Berlin's edema. At 1 month, the edema had subsided, but the OCT showed a subfoveal ISOS junction and ELM defect over a large area, and the ultimate visual acuity could not recover to more than 3 by 60. In another case, a 21-year-old male patient with a history of cricket ball injury in the right eye came to us. At presentation, the visual acuity was counting finger at 2 feet in the presence of traumatic uveitis. At 1 month, the OCT showed a subfoveal ISOS junction and ELM defect, which was smaller in area, but a scar had formed and it was in the very essential subfoveal area, and the visual acuity could not recover to more than 6 by 60. In a very similar case, which came around 2 months later, a 19-year-old male presented again with a history of cricket ball injury. Traumatic uveitis was present at the time of presentation. Visual acuity was 6 by 60. At 1 month, the OCT had a normal ISOS junction and ELM, and the visual acuity recovered to 6 by 6. So to discuss, these are the anatomical layers, which we all know, the all-important layer of rods and cones and the external limiting membrane. This is the ISOS junction. These lines have been called by a lot of different names in different studies. The current preferred nomenclature for ISOS is the ellipsoid zone. What is important is, the factors which are important is whether the integrity is maintained, what is the length of the disruption, and what is the location, whether it is subfoveal or juxtafoveal. Now, there have been a number of studies on this. The first study which I could find was in 2003, where Hikichi et al. Had first proposed that the photoreceptor displacement, if present preoperatively in a macular hole surgery, could impact the postoperative visual acuity. Since then, the ISOS junction or the ellipsoid zone has been found to be significant in a number of diseases like diabetic macular edema, retinal dystrophies, ARMD, macular hole surgery, chronic CSR, but there have been very few studies in the field of blunt trauma. So this is one study by Souza Santos et al., which had showed that acute disruption of the ISOS junction in severe trauma had a poor visual prognosis. And another study by Arn et al. Showed that macular commotio retinae could be graded and that could predict visual and anatomical outcomes. To summarize, while a number of studies have been conducted to find out the role of ISOS junction and ELM in other ophthalmological diseases, very few have been done in blunt trauma patients. Ours is a pilot study proposing the prognostic role of these lines, and it conclusively showed that the visual acuity was progressively decreasing with increasing severity of injury to the lines of vision. The limitations of my study, a low sample size, subjects were chosen in a non-randomized manner, and they were not followed up beyond 1 month. So a larger trial for a longer duration can be done to further confirm these findings. The take-home messages would be that in a blunt trauma patient, the visual acuity at presentation may not always reflect the true ultimate prognosis. While other factors like traumatic uveitis, Berlin's edema, hyphema, they can subside with time, but damage to retina may have a permanent impact on the final visual acuity, and the OCT can be an invaluable tool for explaining the visual prognosis to the patient with the help of these lines of vision. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The information is new?
So as I said, this has been proved in a lot of other diseases. In the field of blunt trauma, I could not find a lot of diseases, a lot of studies.
Reports.
So that is why I did a small study on this.
Did you see any case where you could not just see the details of ELM or ISOS junction?
Yes, sir. When we did the OCT at presentation, in some of the cases, we could not see it. So that is why we have included only the OCTs at the 1 month post-trauma, where the media had become clearer and we could take it for statistical evaluation.
Okay.
How does it translate clinically?
No, so this has been proved actually that there is no whenever break is there. That's why I'm saying anything new that your study is adding up. Or
it does not give any value to doing it, because if the vision, supposing you didn't do it, the vision anyway does not improve. It means that you are assuming that there are retinal structural changes.
Yeah, to prognosticate it is important. That's once it is disrupted, we can say it's further improvement can be done.
It is mainly to explain the prognosis to the patient.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now, can I call upon Dr. Bhagya Sudhir? Her presentation is on polymerase chain reaction and correlation with treatment response in tuberculosis uveitis.
Good morning, respected chairs, seniors and colleagues. My paper is on polymerase chain reaction and its correlation with clinical features in treatment response in tuberculosis uveitis. So we all know that tuberculosis is a disease with high morbidity and mortality, and it has become a significant health issue in both developed and developing nations, especially in the developed world because of the HIV/AIDS epidemic. Intraocular tuberculosis is a major cause of visual disability and blindness. And why is this so? This is because of the variable presentation and the significant overlap, thus making it very difficult to diagnose. Intraocular tuberculosis is a Pauci bacillary disease, as proven by a number of studies, thus making the gold standard smear and culture test of very low sensitivity. Thus, we need to rely on molecular diagnostic techniques such as the polymerase chain reaction because of its higher specificity. So what we did was we analyzed the correlation of nested PCR results with clinical features and treatment response in clinically suspected TB uveitis. The materials and the methods of the study, it was a retrospective observational case series. The period of the study was from April 2012 to 2015 with a minimum follow-up of 6 months. We did it at the tertiary center, Arvind Eye Hospital at Madurai. The inclusion criteria, we had two sets of patients. One was clinically suspicious TB uveitis, and the other set was those patients who had a persistent inflammation on oral steroids. As being a tertiary referral center, a lot of patients who were diagnosed as uveitis were already on high dose of oral steroids. The exclusion criteria were those patients who did not have a minimum follow-up of 6 months. The methods, we did only a nested PCR analysis. We used the probe MPB64. We took the fluid from the anterior chamber tap, the vitreous tap, and the vitreous biopsy. So this is one of our patients who had a positive PCR result. And here you can see the 240 base pair and the 220 base pair of the MPB64. Coming to the results, we had a total of 85 patients, but lost to follow-up were 29, so we excluded them. The results which we analyzed were for 56 patients, of whom 14 of them had an AC tap, 14 vitreous biopsies, and 28 vitreous taps. This is the tabulated column of the demographics and the clinical features of the patients. The mean age was 38 years. The mean duration of the disease was 2 months. We had a slightly unilateral predilection for TB uveitis. We almost had 40 eyes which had a unilateral presentation. 9 of them were immunocompromised, among whom 3 were HIV positive, who were already on complete AR antiretroviral therapy. 14 patients had a past history of tuberculosis. The CT thorax showing evidence of tuberculosis was seen in 7 patients. The MANTU of more than or equal to 15 were seen in 17 of the patients. Coming to the anatomical type of uveitis in the eyes, we found that 36 eyes had a predominant pan-uveitic kind of a presentation. We further went on to analyze the PCR positivity. We divided them basically into acute and chronic uveitis. Among the acute uveitis, we had 31 patients, of whom 16 were PCR positive. And we had a higher yield with anterior uveitis patients. 5 of them were PCR positive, among whom 4 of them were granulomatous type of reaction. This is the clinical photograph of a patient with hypopyon uveitis and iris granuloma secondary to tuberculosis. So we went on to analyze what was the PCR results and what was the clinical response. We found that PCR positivity with clinical response to treatment was seen in 22 patients, whereas with PCR negativity, there was no clinical response in 24 patients. Therefore, we analyzed the sensitivity and the specificity. We had a sensitivity about 73.3%, whereas the specificity was 92.3%. We compared the clinical outcome based on two parameters. One is the vitreous haze. As you can see in this table, there is a significant reduction in the vitreous haze at 6 months follow-up, and the best-corrected visual acuity. So is with the best-corrected visual acuity, we had a p-value of less than 0.001%. Coming to the discussion and conclusion, what I would like to emphasize is intraocular tuberculosis requires a strong clinical suspicion for diagnosis. It requires laboratory and corroborative radiological investigations. Though we all know that smeared and cultured is the gold standard for diagnosing intraocular tuberculosis, a positive PCR test can be a reliable tool, whereas if it is a negative test, we really need to rely on our clinical picture. An adequate treatment response supports the PCR results. We had two similar studies done in 2013 by the Sheepers and Sharma et al. The only difference in the Sharma et al. Study done by the PGI group that it was a multi-targeted PCR. Our study almost showed similar results with the sensitivity and the specificity. So I'd like to conclude by saying that polymerase chain reaction had a sensitivity of 73.3% in our study with a higher specificity of 92.3%. It had a good correlation with the treatment response, and thus it becomes a reliable tool in aiding us to make a diagnosis of intraocular tuberculosis. I thank you all for your patient hearing.
So which cases did you do vitreous biopsy? And because all cases you have not subjected for ACTAP as well as vitreous biopsy.
Yes, sir.
Why did you do that?
Sir, we saw the area of predominant inflammation. Mm-hmm. If the patient had a higher anterior segment inflammation, we subjected the patient to ACTAP. If the vitreous was the more predominant site of inflammation, or if there was a retinochoroiditis, we subjected the vitreous for biopsy.
And you said sensitivity is low, no, 73.
Yeah, it has
what
been
is the implication?
Sir, it has been proven in a lot of studies that the sensitivity is low for PCR, and especially ours is a nested PCR. Now we have the real-time PCR, so that's one of the drawbacks of our study, that we should have actually used real-time. We didn't have access to the machine. Actually, the nested PCR was an in-house PCR that we did.
No, clinically, did you find any implication to that?
We did have a few clinical dilemmas even at the end of the PCR results. So we had a few patients who were already on immunosuppressants who came with an acute retinal necrosis kind of a picture. We subjected them for PCR for viral and TB. We unfortunately got a false positivity for TB. But we went ahead with our clinical diagnosis, and we said that no, it's an ARN, and we treated them with antiviral. There was a good clinical response. So that's why I just wanted to stress to the audience also that we really need to rely on our clinical diagnosis more than on laboratory.
Yeah. So that is the conclusion.
Yes.
PCR, you need to take it with a little bit of pinch of
yes,
salt.
Yes.
Because
too
you need
salts.
To... clinical picture is very, very important, and if there is a slight yield with positive clinical picture,
yes,
then
yes.
Probably you may have, can take. Okay, thank you.
Thank
very
you
much.
So much.
And now, can I call upon Dr. Vani Seth? You're there, please. Her presentation is PCV and CSR. This is of the same spectrum.
Chorioretinopathy, diseases of the same spectrum. Polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy, or PCV, is a described condition consisting of peculiar subretinal polypoidal vascular lesions associated with serous and hemorrhagic pigment epithelial detachments. CSR, or central serous chorioretinopathy, is characterized by idiopathic detachment of the neurosensory retina. There are reports associating these two diseases. History of CSC is seen to be more common in cases with PCV than AMD. Cases of PCV are also associated with changes of chronic CSC. Recently, these have been grouped together in pachychoroid disease spectrum. The purpose of this study was to study the multimodal imaging features in cases with suspected PCV, looking for simultaneous presence of CSC. It was a retrospective case series in which the clinical and imaging data of 181 cases of suspected PCV was studied, and the relevant history, visual acuity, clinical features along with OCT, FFA, and ICG features was noted. We could identify 5 eyes of 5 patients which had presence of both the diseases, features of CSC as well as PCV. The mean age was 63.2 years, 3 were male and 2 were females. The first case was a 52-year-old female who presented with complaint of defective vision in right eye for 6 months. The OCT showed a notched PED with a polyp beneath, along with serous macular detachment overlying a thickened choroid with a choroidal thickness of 406 micrometers. On FFA, there was a typical smokestack leak superonasal to the fovea. On ICG, we identified polyps at an entirely separate location, which was inferior to the fovea. On OCT, again, we could detect a micro rib corresponding to the area of the smokestack leak. Second case is a 70-year-old male who presented a defective vision for 2 months. On OCT, he had irregular peaked PEDs with subretinal fluid overlying a thickened choroid. FFA showed an ink blot leak superotemporal to the fovea, and ICG showed subfoveal polyps, cluster of polyps. Third case was a 65-year-old male with defective vision in left eye. He was being treated for query PCV or CNVM. On OCT, there were irregular PEDs with subretinal fluid and subretinal heme. FFA revealed a smokestack leak inferotemporal to the fovea along with subfoveal polyps on ICG. The fourth case was a 67-year-old male who had defective vision for 14 days. The subfoveal the OCT showed irregular PEDs with subretinal fluid overlying a thickened choroid. FFA showed an ink blot leak inferotemporal to the fovea with superotemporal polyps. Fifth case was a 62-year-old female with defective vision in both eyes for 6 months. The left eye OCT showed an undulated RPE subfoveally, but nasal to the disc was a large PED with subretinal fluid. On FFA, there was a typical smokestack leak nasal to the disc, and ICG showed polyps superior to the disc. So, to summarize, in our case series, irregular PEDs were noted in 4 cases, notched or peaked in 2 cases, subretinal fluid in all the cases with heme in 3 and exudates in 1. The mean subfoveal choroidal thickness was 371.2 microns with dilated outer choroidal vessels in all the cases. FFA showed an ink blot leak in 2 cases and smokestack leak in 3. ICG showed macular polyps in 2 cases and extramacular in 3 cases. Coming to discussion, the pathogenesis of both these diseases is unclear. However, there is an increasing role of choroidal congestion and hyperpermeability in both these diseases. A pachychoroid has been defined as an abnormal increase in the choroidal thickness associated with enlarged outer choroidal vessels and the attenuation of the choriocapillaries and settlar layers. The disease spectrum includes 2 other diseases other than PCV and CSC, which is a pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy and a pachychoroid neovasculopathy. So to put all these into a spectrum of diseases, if in a hyperpermeable thick choroid, the RPE is able to overcome the fluid overload, just few pigmentary changes are seen where we can see it is a PPE. If not, then the serous macular detachment results, resulting into a CSR. Both these conditions lead to stress on RPE, which can cause microrips in the RPE and the Bruch's membrane. And if these are associated with the neovascularization type 1, then we can see a pachychoroid neovasculopathy. A pachychoroid neovasculopathy or a hyperpermeable choroid, both can lead to a PCV. The limitations of this study were its retrospective nature, and the follow-ups are not included in this particular study. So to conclude, here, for the first time, we are able to demonstrate two separate disease manifestations at separate locations in the same eye simultaneously. This gives a direct evidence to the hypothesis that CSR and PCV belong to the same spectrum of diseases overlying a thick choroid. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you very much. In idiopathic polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy.
Yes, sir.
Where is the lesion?
So the lesion?
Level of lesion.
Level of lesion.
So level of lesion, they say it does not.
Where is the level of lesion? Retina, choroid, pigment.
Choroid. Yes, sir.
In CSR, where is the lesion?
So they say it's in the RP.
In CSR.
Subretinal. Subretinal fluid collection.
In central serous retinopathy.
RPE, sir. RPE.
Is there a difference between RPE and choroid?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
No, actually, this this pachychoroid is the new concept which is evolving. That's why CSR is part of the pachychoroid pathology. That's why she is proposing, is it same or different? So did you do anything that the evolution is like initially CSR and then later turned out to be PCV in these cases?
Not in this case series, sir. There are reports
that is what is missing in your presentation. Actually,
yes, sir, not in this case.
Your hypothesis is that CSR and PCV is the same spectrum. to support the hypothesis, is your cases supporting it or not?
So it is, in these cases, we see two separate disease manifestations and a thickened choroid in the entire, overlying the entire fundus. So we can group together in the same spectrum of diseases. How one after the other evolves, further studies are required with a longer follow-up.
Okay. That is what is required, actually.
Yes, sir, that is required.
Please come up with that.
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And before concluding, I will read three names of the presenters who are not there. That is Revathi Subramani, Dr. V.P. Gupta, and Dr. J.L. Goyal. They are still not there, so we will declare that this session is concluded. We are totaling all the scores, which are independently done, and then we are submitting to the scientific committee. During the validatory function, the winner will be declared.
Do we do it now, sir?
In fact, we are not totaling it also. We are just handing it over to the chairman, scientific committee office.
मैं उधर चले जाऊं फिर
कब जाओ
10 मिनट में भी उधर बोल के
आता अच्छा हां बिकॉज
एट लीस्ट ही विल बी हैप्पी ही विल बी हैप्पी वर्ल्ड सोसाइटी
व्हिच वर्ल्ड सोसाइटी
ये तो
सबमिट द चेंज
या थैंक यू
Who were the three absentees?
Dr. Revathi Subramani.
The front is to be filled, no?
No. This is
not.
Revathi Subramani.
Gupta.
Revathi is one. Revathi in the first page. And Revathi Subramani. Dr. Goyal, J.L. Goyal.
V.P. Gupta and
J.L.
V.P. Goyal, J.L.
Goyal.
Two. Goyal, J.L.
I will give to either Ananda or Natasha. Anand says epidemiological implication and the Natasha will be.